Well, hey, y'all. Hey, happy Monday, everybody. Welcome everyone to Saki Speakeasy Podcast. I'm your host, Saki Speaks, and I appreciate you giving me a bit of your most precious commodity, your time. Y'all, do me a favor. I feel pretty good today. I do. So y'all, show my moderator Love Jones some love and affection moving in the right direction. And please make sure that you liked the video on your way in, please, and thank you. And if you haven't already, again, I'm not sure why you haven't. But go ahead and subscribe to the channel, please, and thank you. It's a good time over here. I promise we only bite if you're into that sort of thing, okay? But make sure after you subscribe that you click that notification bell and select all so you won't miss out on an opportunity to chill with us when the speakeasy is open for business, all right? So with that being said, welcome to all of my new sippers and speakers. Thank you so much for subscribing to my little janky podcast. I hope you find a reason to stick around. And welcome back to my returning sippers and speakers, and those of you catching this on the replay, thank you so much for coming back one more again to love up on your girl, because y'all know I love the way y'all love on me, all right? So, let me see who's in the building so we can get this party started, because I'm going to tell y'all now. I was told by a little birdie, y'all know we were going to start with ethic, right? Book one. But I was told that we should probably read this book first in order to get, I guess, a little bit of background on the ethic character. So, okay. I don't want us to be over here all discombobulated and disjointed. So I'm going to follow directions and do as I'm told. So we're going to start with this one. But let me see who's in the building. Hey, Love Jones, moderator extraordinaire. Happy Monday, lovey. Welcome, welcome. Thank you so much for being here, darling. I appreciate you. Honestly, Kay is in the building. Welcome, darling. Happy Monday to you as well. Thank you so much for being here. I appreciate you. Well, hello. I am Diamond Dondria. Welcome, darling. Happy Monday to you as well. Thank you so much for being here, lovey. I appreciate you. And learning to love myself. Well, hashi tashi, grasshopper. And happy Monday to you, darling. Thank you so much for being in the bushes. I appreciate you. All right, so let me get my my time stamp for my synopsis here. All right, so today we are reading Moth to a Flame. And the synopsis reads, in the little city of Flint, Michigan, the good die young and the people left standing are the grimiest of characters. With reign over the city's drug trade, Benjamin Atkins made sure that his precious daughter, Raven, was secluded from the grit that the city had to offer. But when Raven's young heart gets claimed by Mizan, a stick-up kid in search of a come-up, there's nothing Benjamin can do about losing her to the streets. She chooses love over loyalty and runs off with Mizan, but her new role as wifey soon proves to be more than she can handle. Puppy love always feels right, but things turn stale. And she soon finds that everyone she loves has disappeared. All she has is Mizan. But when hugs and kisses turn to bloody lips and black eyes, she realizes that Mizan is not who she thought he was. Raven becomes desperate for a way out. But this time, Daddy can't save her. Every time she finds the courage to leave, fear convinces her to stay. Like a moth to a flame, Raven is drawn to Mizan, even though she knows he'll be the death of her. When the hood life she chooses becomes unbearable and the only way out is in a coffin, what will she do? All right, y'all, listen. Now, we were told that there's some assault that takes place in this book. So, y'all, listen. y'all know how I am about protecting my peace, so. I'm hoping that this shit don't put me over the edge, you heard me, because I'm not in the mood. I'm feeling real good today. The sun is shining, all right? The birds are chirping. There was a bird outside. I don't even know what kind of bird it was, but it had the most beautiful melody this morning. And I was just like, oh my God, the universe is so awesome. Like, we all have our own little melody, y'all. Did you ever think about that? Like, we all have our own little soundtrack to our lives. And that little bird had it wasn't like a regular bird chirping. This was melodic and sweet. Or maybe the universe was just, you know, showing me a little love because it did extend my life contract for one more day, and I'm grateful for it. You heard me? Listen, bitch is going through it, but stay out my goddamn business. Hey, Marva, welcome, darling. Thank you so much for being here. I appreciate you, and happy Monday to you. All right, so let's get into this thing, child, and see what it's giving. All right, so let me get my time stamp, honey, and then we can see what's crack-a-lacking with this, because if it's boo-boo, y'all know I'll drop it. Prologue. Raven sped through the city streets with her best friend, Nikki, in the passenger seat. She kept checking her rearview mirror to make sure no one was following her. I have to get out of here before he wakes up and finds out I'm gone, she said desperately as she made her way across town, trying to get to Mizan's last trap house. Robbing him blind had been her only option. Oh my God, I'll if you hear me, all right? She had nowhere to go, and she had no choice but to leave. He grew more violent as each day passed, and she could not take it anymore. She'd been forced to take the money and get out of Dodge. If she hadn't, he would have eventually killed her. So far, she had $100,000 in her possession, but she had one more stop to make. She had collected from all of Mizan's stash spots except for this last one. Although this dope spot was out of her way on the other side of town, she knew she could not skip it. This spot usually made more money than the rest of them combined, so there was no way that she was leaving town without hitting that safe. After everything he had put her through, she felt like she deserved every cent she was taking. With every tear he had caused her to shed, she had earned it. This was her reparation. When she finally pulled up to the small yellow house on the city's north side, she turned to Nikki. I'll be right back. If I'm not out in 10 minutes, you pull off. She looked in the back seat at her newborn baby boy who was sleeping soundly. If anything goes wrong, you take him to the bridge at Mott Park. Ethic will be waiting. He'll take care of him, Raven said urgently. She lowered her head and pulled a pink envelope out of her purse. If something happens to me, make sure Ethic gets this. Nikki shook her head and then hugged her friend. Give it to him yourself. Nothing is going to happen, Ray. Just hurry up so you can get out of here, Nikki stated. Raven nodded, hopped out of the car, and ran inside the trap house. Mizan's workers were not surprised to see her. She was the only person besides Mizan who came by regularly. The 1st and the 15th were the days that she collected the profit Mizan had made from the streets. Only this time, she didn't plan on turning them in. She was going to use the money to take her life back. She was purchasing her freedom on Mizan's dime. Because of him, she had lost everything, and now it was payback time. All the black eyes he had given her, all the bruises she'd been forced to cover up, all the lies he had told, they were all about to come back on him. She was determined to deliver his karma to him personally. By robbing him blind, she was going to give him the ultimate fuck you and knock him off the throne he had stolen from her father. She was going to take him for everything he had and disappear into the night. Her hands trembled as she avoided eye contact with Mizan's workers. She watched the money machine as it counted the bills, making a rhythm in her head. The money symbolized her emancipation. All she had to do was make it out of the last stash house and she would be home free. Her foot tapped anxiously against the carpeted floor as she waited impatient. She turned to look out the window and saw that the coast was still clear. Hurry the fuck up, she thought eagerly, as she tried to remain cool on the outside. Fear pumped through her veins like blood as the last stack was loaded into the machine. $135,000, the worker reported as he began to put the money inside a duffel bag. Once she added back to the money she already had in the car, she would be almost a quarter of $1 million richer. That was enough for her to start her life over in a new city. I can become a new person, she thought. He'll never find me. Raven helped the dude load the cash into the bag and then grabbed it out of his hands before rushing out of the house. She popped the trunk and threw it inside before getting into the car. She pulled out of the driveway so fast that she left burnt rubber on the pavement. How much is it? Almost a quarter mil in total, Raven said as tears came to her eyes. She gripped her abdomen tightly, feeling sick to her stomach. She was still recuperating from her hard labor, and the pain of moving was making it hard for her to escape, but she had to keep pushing. The pain would be much greater if she stayed with Mizan, and the memories of all the fucked up things he'd done to her kept her pushing forward. I can finally get away, Nick. I can use this money to hide out and get away from all of this madness, she whispered as her soul cried. Her father's face flashed in her mind as she thought of everything that she'd been through. Mizan had tried his hardest to break her, and she'd almost let him. By forgiving him repeatedly, she had sent the message that it was acceptable for him to hurt her, but today was her day. Today, her entire life was about to change. "You know you can't come back this time," Nikki said, worried. She knew Raven like the back of her hand. She had attempted to leave Mizan before, but she always came back, like a moth to a flame. Raven was drawn to Mizan. It was something that no one could ever understand. "You can't let him say he's sorry and you go running home. You have to leave him for good, Raven. If you don't, he gonna kill you." "I know. I'm not going back to him. I swear on everything I love that it's over. I can't take this no more. He's taken everything away from me, and he's hurt everyone I love," she whispered as she reached over and squeezed Nikki's hand. "I'm so sorry, Nick. I'm sorry for everything." "Girl, none of that matters. Let the past be just that, the past. Leave all the bullshit behind. You're getting out now, and that's all that counts," Nikki replied. "I finally have something to fight for." Raven looked back at her sleeping infant. "I just want to keep my baby safe." Nikki smiled and rubbed her friend's hair gently. "We're going to get you out of here. We're almost there." As Raven headed toward Mott Park, she remembered the day she first met Mizan. She had been so young and naive to trust him. Now she was caught in his deadly web of deceit, and the closer she got to leaving him, the more afraid she became. It would be so much easier for her to stay with him and go with the flow, but she was tired of being his punching bag. She was exhausted from fighting day in and day out. A part of her wanted to turn around and go back home, but as she drove, she reminded herself of all the pain he had caused. This is what kept her pushing forward, kept her foot on the gas. As she made her final escape, she thought about her life, reflecting on the very first time she had met Mizan, the man who ruined her life. All right, now. I don't know. Here we go, y'all. Oh, Jesus, good googly woogly. You're saying the first chapter is 40 minutes long? Okay. Child, listen, it's 23 chapters and an epilogue. But we're going to soldier through. I don't know, child. Let's see. All right. Get my time stamp, child. This first chapter. Jesus. Jesus. Okay. I'm going to try to see if I can soldier through. I don't know. I'm going to see how many I can get through. At the 2-hour mark, I'll probably stop and then do another one. Because, child, listen, I don't want these videos to be super long because I think people, kind of pass them up when they're over 2 hours. So, yeah. All right. Let me get my time stamp. This better be good, too. Well, I am going to find Nordic E.T. highly favored and kick off in their ass. You heard me? They're like, bitch, I ain't tell you. I suggested it. I didn't tell you you had to do it. Don't be bringing me your shit. Oh, my goodness. All right, y'all. Oh, Lord have mercy. All right, here we go. Chapter 1. Nah, nah, nah. Diva is a female version of a hustler, of a hustler, of a hustler. Bitch, why are we bumping this old ass shit? Nikki shouted, trying to be heard over the subwoofers that vibrated her seat as she bobbed her head to the beat. Because ain't no better way to announce me, babes. I'm a diva. I'm a diva, Raven responded with a playful arrogance as she whipped her shiny brand new Lexus coupe down Clio Road, one of the hottest strips in the entire city. It was the day of the annual Memorial Day celebration, and everybody who was anybody was out riding the strip as they waited for the festivities to begin. Heads turned as everyone tried to catch sight of the infamous Raven Atkins. The lyrics to the song may have been old, but as the local hustlers, stopped in their tracks to catch a glimpse of the light-skinned beauty, Raven knew that the words rang true. Around the city of Flint, Michigan, Beyonce didn't have shit on her. She was hood royalty, the daughter of Benjamin Atkins, the most notorious kingpin the city had seen thus far. And she wore her title well. Her coach kicks, tight skinny jeans, and casual white baby tee were simple. But the curves of her voluptuous 5'7" frame transformed simple into chic. Niggas were thirsty as they tried to get at her, spitting whack game, each hoping that he would be the lucky one she chose. She was so fly that even the bitches couldn't hate on her. They wanted to, but all they could do was stop and stare while thinking, she put her shit together so right. She wasn't the type of chick who bought knockoffs or rocked $100 weaves done by $10 beauticians. And she definitely wasn't the chick who wore a nice hookup but accessorized her shit all wrong. No. Raven Atkins was a top-notch bitch with top-notch shit. And when she stepped out, not a hair on her head was out of place. She had gotten it from her mama, learning to be a lady from the best who had ever done it. At only 17, Raven knew her position and she played it like little ghetto girls played double dutch. She was the princess of the city, and just in case anyone didn't know it, she had it tattooed on her wrist and engraved on the plush leather headrest of her car. How did you get your dad to let you out the house? Nikki asked as she pulled down her visor and applied lip gloss. He thinks I'm staying the night at your place. You think Auntie Gina will mind? She asked, turning to her best friend with a concerned look on her face. The last thing she needed was to get caught in a lie by her father. He was extra strict with her. And if he had any idea that she was in the inner city, there would be hell to pay. Girl, please, it's nothing. You know my mama ain't tripping, Nikki replied as she stepped out of the car. You drinking? She asked as she headed into the liquor store. You know it, Raven called back, still in the car. Ciroc and lemonade. As she watched her friend disappear inside the store, she smiled. They had been true blue since grade school, and she loved her dearly. Where other girls had tried to cling to her to upgrade their status, Nikki was there from the very beginning, before her father had arrived into his own. She would never forget the love and loyalty that Nikki had shown her over the years, which was why whenever Raven got something, so did Nikki. It was like Benjamin had two teenage daughters because whatever he bought for Raven, she conned him into buying a matching item for her girl. Now that's love, y'all. That's sweet. As she nodded her head to the music, a shiny black Escalade pulled up next to her. Chatham Escalades is trouble, do you hear me? And the shiny black niggas driving, but anyway. Behind the tint of her Chloe sunglasses, she eyed the big boy toy. The bass from the speaker system could be felt all the way in her car. The dark-skinned, freshly seasoned eye candy sitting comfortably behind the wheel caused her to raise her glasses and look his way. He noticed her staring and gave her a nod. He smirked as she lowered her glasses and turned up her radio. Licking his lips, he reached down for his own custom system and drowned out her volume. The sounds of young Jeezy invaded her car. Not wanting to be outdone, she frowned in displeasure as she turned off her car and walked inside the store. She stepped with a model's precision and commanded attention as her hips swayed from side to side. But the one dude she hoped would be watching had switched his focus to another girl. What the fuck? Is he serious? She asked herself as she quickly assessed her competition. A Reebok bra with ass for days had stolen the dude's attention away from her. Even Raven had to admit the girl did have a humongous ass. There was no way her size 10 jeans could compete with that. She rolled her eyes and turned to go into the store, but Nikki was already on her way out. What's up? Did you forget something? Nikki asked. Giving the dude another glance, she shook her head. Nah, I was just coming to see what was taking you so long. I'm ready to go inside the club. Raven walked back to her car and gave the dude one last glance before pulling away. She checked her rearview mirror to see if he had stepped out of the car and noticed that he was sporting out-of-town plates. Missouri, she thought. Her interest in him immediately doubled. It was nothing better than putting claims on a fresh, out-of-town nigga like him. Flint was so small that everybody knew everybody. An unknown face was a challenge, and the rule always was that the first chick to become a wifey won. Raven knew that dude didn't know who she was. But when he checked her status, he would come to his senses. I might not give the nigga no kicket just for showing out, she thought. She popped in her Crescent Michelle and pulled out of the parking lot, leaving skid marks on the pavement while Crescent crooned from her speakers and serenaded the envious onlookers. And there's a pause in the camera. In the camera, child, listen, in the chapter. Damn, look at the line to get in, Nikki commented as they pulled into the parking lot of the Palm Tree, a small club on the city's north side. You know I'm not waiting in line, Raven stated, as she parked and hopped out. She bypassed the entire line, speaking to people she knew as she made her way to the front. The bouncer stopped her dead in her tracks. No, no, baby girl. Your father is not about to have my fucking head, he said, as he refused to let her in. Jerome was one of her father's old bodyguards, and he knew the repercussions that could come his way if he allowed her inside. Jerome, don't play with me. Come on, let me and my girl in. You know I'm the life of the party. Raven planted one hand on her hip. I can't do it, Ray. What you doing out here anyway, Ma? You ain't even old enough to be up in here, isn't? You gonna have me lose my job if I let you up in this motherfucker. Raven pulled out a wad of money and peeled off two $100 bills. She placed them in his shirt pocket as she smiled sweetly and stepped into the club, disregarding his protests. Thank you, Jerome. I'll make sure I tell my daddy you said what up, she shouted over him as she waved her fingers and strolled in. He shook his head in doubt. Nah, if your pops find out, don't say shit about me, Ray. I'm serious. I didn't let you in here, he yelled as she disappeared into the establishment with Nikki holding her hand. Everybody showed her love as she navigated through the wall-to-wall crowd. Damn, it ain't even any tables left, Nikki said as she checked her Cartier. It's not even 11 o'clock and it's already packed. I know. I didn't come here to sit down anyway, Raven stated as she made her way to the dance floor. She lifted her hands and swayed arrogantly to the club track as she snapped her fingers. She and Nikki were the center of attention, everyone around them raising their hands to rock with the beat as the twosome did their thing. Conceit was written all over both of their faces. They were so much alike that they played off of each other's movements as they commanded the crowd. A couple of songs passed before they decided to end their show and make their way over to the bar. Raven felt someone grab her hand. She turned and smiled when she saw who was trying to get her attention. As her eyes scanned him quickly, she saw that he was attractive. He passed all of her tests. In order for a dude to even step to her, he had to qualify. She had a rule system and, unlike so many others, her rules were not made to be broken. Rule number one, the dude had to be fine as hell. And as she stared at this dude's gray eyes, she had to admit that there weren't any ugly genes in his body. Okay, check, she thought. Rule number two, the dude couldn't be a cornball ass nigga. There was nothing worse than a corny man. And she could tell if a guy had swag or not just by the way he walked. The dude in front of her didn't try too hard to be cool. He exuded confidence in a casual stroll. And not once did he grab his penis, which was a plus in her book. She hated dudes who walked around holding their crotches. It usually meant that there wasn't much to hold on to. The gesture was crass and unattractive for sure. Okay, check, she thought, growing more impressed by the second. She continued to inventory him in her head. Rule three, any dude trying to mess with her had to be paid. She came from a long line of hustlers and get money cats. So any dude trying to impress her would have to be a thoroughbred just like her daddy. Is he paid? She asked herself. Yeah, nigga, you paid. That presidential you rocking ain't affordable to many. Check. Rule four, the nigga shoe game had to be on point. And as she peeped at his brand new Air Jordans, she was satisfied. They were official, straight out of Foot Locker, not the hood corner store. Dude passed her tests with flying colors without having a clue that she had just peeped his entire style in just a few seconds. His boyish features made her smile, but she knew that she was fucking with a grown man just from the way he looked at her. He walked up on her as if he knew her, not leaving any personal space between them. Pause. So he a disrespectful ass nigga. No God. Mm-mm. I don't think so. Hey, Nordic. Happy Monday. Welcome. Thank you so much for being here. I appreciate you. Yeah, I was just saying, I'm going to kick off in your ass if this book is trash. If you rewind back to the front, you'll hear me say it because you're the one who told me to start with this book. So it better be good. So far, we all right. We just in chapter one. All right, let me get back to it. What up, Mom? You getting a lot of love in here. I just came over to find out who the star is, he whispered in her ear. What's your name? Raven, but you can call me Ray, she answered sweetly. Ray, you want to come have a drink with me, he asked. I got my girl with me, she replied as she shook her head to decline his offer. That was one thing she never did, leave her girl on stuck to kick it with a dude. Your girl can come too, he stated as he put his arms around Raven and Nikki. He escorted them to his table where a few of his friends were popping bottles and enjoying the club scene. I don't even know your name, she whispered in his ear as she cradled a drink in her hand. Her underage lips touched the glass. She sipped the vodka and cranberry while awaiting his response. I'm Mizan, he replied as he took her drink from her. How old are you? 21, she answered quickly as she snatched her drink back. She already knew she would lie when he asked her. A dude like Mizan could have his pick of the women in the room. She knew that if she revealed her real age, he would instantly dismiss her. "Why, how old are you?" "I'm 22," he replied. Just as she was about to respond, she spotted the cutie she had seen earlier at the store. Her eyes followed him across the room. He looked good enough to eat, and she instantly decided that one day he was going to be her man. She stared at him from across the room, her eyes burning a hole through him. He must have felt the heat because he looked up and their eyes met. Neither of them made it a point to look away too quickly. As she studied every feature on his face, she was mesmerized. Everything about him was so on point. His hood swagger was out of this world. She was on cloud nine as people partied around her. Only when the DJ cut the music did she snap out of her trance. "The fire department is shutting us down. We're over capacity," he shouted over the microphone. "Party's over." Boos and groans erupted throughout the crowd. Raven stood up, Nikki by her side. "Looks like our night has been cut short," she said, facing Mizan. "It doesn't have to be. We can kick it back at my place," he answered as he led her out of the club. Raven frowned and replied, "I don't know you like that." Part of her wanted to roll out with Mizan and his crew, but she knew that if her father ever found out she had gone back to a nigger's crib, he would kill her, and probably Mizan, too. "You can give me your number so that I can call you, though," she said with a sugar lace in her tone. "Well, we can link up another time." Mizan pulled out his BlackBerry so that he could swap information with her, but before she could give him her number, gunshots rang out. Boom, boom, boom. Must have been a 4-5. Anyway, sorry. "Ah!" Raven screamed as she instinctively ducked low and covered her ears. The crowd began to run in all directions. "Nikki!" she reached out, trying to locate her best friend. The sea of panicked faces in the parking lot didn't make it any easier to locate her. Mizan grabbed her hand and ran towards his car. "Get in!" he yelled. "I have to find my girl!" she replied with worry. "She ran off with one of my niggas. You can call her when you get in the car," Mizan stated with authority. Boom, 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 boom. Hearing another round of shots ring out, Raven didn't hesitate to jump inside Mizan's car. He was parked at the edge of the parking lot so he didn't get caught in the barrage of cars trying to get out. She saw her car stuck in the back. "My car! I have to get my car! I'll bring you back to it once the crowd clears and the shooting stops. You good with me? Trust me," Mizan said in an attempt to reassure her. Raven's cell phone vibrated and she quickly answered it when she saw Nikki's picture pop up on the screen. "Where are you?" Raven answered. "I'm with one of the dudes from the club. I just wanted to make sure you were straight," Nikki replied. "Yeah, I'm good. I'm with Mizan." "Where you want to meet up?" Raven asked. "I'm gonna chill with dude for a minute. Let's meet back at your car in a couple of hours," Nikki stated. "Aye, that's cool." Mizan reached over and brushed a stray hair from Raven's face. "You good, Ma? You look kind of shook over there. You live in Flint, so I know you done heard gunshots before, superstar," he teased. She cut her eyes at him and pursed her lips. "Shut up. I wasn't scared. That ain't nothing new to me," she replied, trying to play tough. But in actuality, it was new to her. Yes, she had heard about the murders and mayhem that her hometown had to offer. She even knew that her father was behind a lot of the madness, but he had kept her far removed from the chaos. So, to be so up close to a shootout had indeed shaken her. "Yeah, all right, tough girl," he stated in a disbelieving tone with a smile. "So you gonna let me spend some time with you, Mom? Get to know you?" "Yeah, we can work something out," she blushed, slightly flattered because Mizan was so much older than she was. He took her back to his north side home and they sat in his driveway. Raven was inexperienced with older men. She was usually confident and commanded the conversation, but with him, she felt awkward, as if nothing she had to say would matter to him. To avoid looking stupid, she remained quiet. He studied her curiously. And as he stared at her, she became insecure. She was conscious of every imperfection on her body. Like most young girls, she was cocky, but not truly confident in herself, relying on her looks too much, allowing her intelligence to take a backseat in order to attract the nigga. "Damn, it feel like I got a booger. Is my hair still in place?" She fidgeted in her seat and flicked her long hair behind her shoulders as she took a deep breath. "Not it feel like I got a booger." I guess you do be kind of thinking about that when you're talking to people. That's why you always do a nostril check before you hop out the whip. You know what I'm saying? Make sure your shit's straight. Cool and collected, Mizan chuckled. "You all right over there, shorty? You nervous?" "I'm good," she responded. "Nah, you nervous, Ma. Loosen up. I got something that'll make you feel right," he said as he reached over her and pulled a bag of Kush marijuana out of the glove compartment. "You smoke?" he asked with a mischievous smile. She nodded. Although she had tried it before, she wasn't really a weed head, but she was not about to tell him that. Yeah, I'm on with that. No, yeah, I'm on that with you, she replied, trying to sound cool. Mizan split the cigar and emptied the legal contents, then replaced it with his own concoction of marijuana and cocaine. Wait, no God, sir. Not marijuana and the cocoa. No, that's not what we're doing here. See, that's what turns marijuana into a gateway drug when you get to putting shit on it. It don't need nothing. It's like good sex. It don't need nothing. If it's good weed, it don't need nothing. Nothing. Why you sprinkling salt on something that's already well seasoned? No, sir. Anyway, Raven noticed that he sprinkled the white powder on top of the kush, and her heart began to speed up anxiously. She knew that some people lace their weed to get a better high, but it wasn't something she was curious about trying. As she watched him for wait, what? As she watched him's tongue, okay, watched, I guess she meant his tongue, formed the blunt, a lump formed in her throat. He lit it, and a funny smell filled the car as a hypnotizing trail of smoke danced around her head. I'd have been like, can you take me back to my car? Because what the fuck? Mm-mm. The smoke was seductive as it consumed the car slowly. He extended his hand to Raven, the glowing tip staring her in the eye. Hit this, Ma, he choked out as smoke left his mouth. Peer pressure is a mother to a 17-year-old girl trying to be down. There was no way she was going to tell him no. All the years of preaching and teaching from her parents had been flushed down the drain as soon as an older boy put something new in her head. Her conscience screamed along, no. Yet she ignored the tiny voice and reached for the blunt. Knowing she was doing wrong, she pouted her perfect pretty lips and puffed on the blunt, causing an amber glow to spark on the tip as she hit the weed. Her lips went numb as she allowed the smoke into her lungs. She held the blunt out for him to take back, but he shook his head. You hit that a few more times, he said. Trash, this nigga's garbage. Raven leaned back in her seat and continued to blaze, her head relaxed against the headrest. After smoking it halfway by herself, her eyelids were heavy and she felt so right. The high had her stuck, and she smiled dumbly as she put the blunt to Mizan's lips. He toked and then asked, you feeling all right? I'm good, she replied as she coughed. They sat in his driveway talking and joking for hours. Now that she was at ease, the conversation flowed smoothly and they got to know one another. Once the initial tension went away, she was so comfortable with him and enjoyed his company. Things just flowed between them. Before she knew it was time for her to meet back up with Nikki. We better go. It's getting late, she said. You're welcome to stay the night, Mizan stated in a low tone. He had no problem having an all-night fuck session with her. In fact, it was what he'd had in his mind from the first moment he saw her. He wasn't a man of good intentions, and a mature woman may have peeped game, but Raven was blind to everything except for his good looks and hood appeal. She felt her love box thump, and she tensed up as Mizan leaned across the seat to kiss her lips. His tongue slid into her mouth so smooth as if he had done this a thousand times before. His tongue tasted like candy. He was teasing her and making the temperature in the car rise from his expert seduction. He kissed her unlike she had ever been kissed before. He was a grown man, and the way his hands touched her neck to pull her closer let her know that anyone she had dealt with before was an amateur. She would have to be careful with her young heart because he could easily capture it. Child, that's the drugs. Trust me. No. If you were sober, you would be like, can you take me back to my friend, please? You fine and all that, but I'm ready to go. Plus, my daddy might kick off in my ass if I'm taking home on time. But the drugs got you fucked up. All right. She was playing in an entirely new league, and she hoped she wasn't biting off more than she could chew. Child, you did that when you got in his car. Intimidation filled her, but her wet panties urged her on. She was curious, and the pulse of lust that throbbed on her clit had her going crazy. She instantly knew that he was more experienced than she was. His resume of conquest was 3 pages long, and he was about to make her another notch on his belt. You want to come in for a minute? He asked. Nigga, I'm not a jump off, she said seriously as she pulled back slightly. I'm just trying to kick it with you, shorty. Kill all that attitude. She loved the way he commanded her. He took charge of her and kept her in check. There was something mysterious about him that she liked. Let me just call my girl to let her know what's up. As she looked down at her phone, she saw that it was off. The battery had died, so she switched the battery and powered it back on to see that she had missed 7 calls. As soon as it came to life, it vibrated in her hands. Nikki's face popped on the caller ID. "Hey, girl, I was just about to call you," Raven said. "Bitch, where you been? I've been blowing you up. Your dad called my house, and my mama told him you weren't there. He been trying to call you. He's pissed the fuck off, Ray. He's got his people out looking for you and everything. You need to get to your car and go to the crib." "Thanks, girl." Raven tried to keep her cool in front of Mizan, but inside her heart was beating out of her chest and her gut instantly bubbled over. "Fuck, fuck, fuck," she shouted in her head as her hands began to sweat. "I need to get back to my car." Her voice trembled a little when she spoke, and the pit of her stomach felt hollow. She tried to come up with a lie, but at that moment, the only thing she could think of was facing her father's wrath. "My shit was so sloppy tonight. I never get caught up like this," she thought, beating herself up. "I should have had Nick forward the calls from her mom's house phone to her cell phone. Fuck." "Everything all right?" Mizan asked as he backed out of the driveway and headed back to the club. "Yeah, I just need to get back to my car. Can you drive a little bit faster?" she asked, her entire mood changing. When they got to the club, she jumped out of the car. "I'll call you," she stated quickly as she unlocked her whip. "Yo, where your girl at?" Mizan asked, looking around the deserted parking lot. "She got into something. I'm good, though," Raven responded. "Nah, Ma, I'm gonna follow you home and make sure you get in the house safely," Mizan said. "No!" Raven shouted. Mizan frowned when he heard the urgency in her voice. She caught herself and finished. "I'm okay. I don't live too far from here. I'll get at you tomorrow." Raven got into her car and pulled off, pushing her pedal to the floor as she tried to make it home. And there's a break in the chapter. Listen, Linda. The universe was universe. She didn't need her first time with him for her to be high off of the yayo and the kush. Yeah, no, that ain't she too young for that. Hell, it's grown ass women that can't handle that. Nah, fam, sorry. Raven hit 90 miles per hour on the freeway trying to make it to Grand Blanc. When she finally arrived at her house, all of the lights were on inside. She knew that both her mother and father were waiting for her. It felt like judgment day as she turned off her car and took a deep breath, preparing herself for the worst. Just as she stepped out of her car, she saw a pair of headlights pull into the driveway behind her. She turned around and her eyes widened in a panic when she saw Mizan's car. "What are you doing here?" she asked as she rushed over to him. She looked back to her front door and her heart beat out of her chest when she saw the porch light come on. "It's 4 o'clock in the morning, shorty. I wasn't gonna let you drive to the crib by yourself. I was just making sure you made it here safely," he said as he got out of the car. "You gotta go, like now," she stated. But when she saw her parents step outside, she knew that it was too late. She was gonna have to face the music. There was no lying her way out of this. Her mother and father came over to her. "Benny Atkins is your pops?" Mizan asked as he looked at her for answers. A lump formed in her throat. All she could do was nod. Her father stepped to her and took her chin in his hands. He moved her face from side to side to see if his precious daughter had been ruined. "Do you know what time it is? Where have you been?" "I was on the strip," she admitted, avoiding her father's icy glare. She wanted to lie to him, but insulting his intelligence would just get her in deeper trouble. He stared at her, then his cold eyes graced Mizan. "Who the fuck is this nigga and why is he in my driveway?" Benjamin asked as he stared Mizan in his eyes. "No disrespect, fam. I just followed her to the crib to make sure she made it here all right. I'm Mizan," he stated as he held out his hand, trying to be cordial. He knew exactly who Benny Atkins was and how he got down. He had also heard that he had a daughter who was off limits. If he had known who Raven was, he would have never stepped to her. Benjamin looked at Mizan's hand and frowned in disapproval. "Who the fuck is this little nigga, Raven?" he asked. "Listen, he sound like my dad. Who the fuck is this nigga?" "Oh, my God. He's just a friend, Daddy," she replied. "Mommy, he's just a friend." Her eyes pleaded with her mother to intervene before her father lost his cool. Justine Atkins stepped up and shook Mizan's hand. "It's nice to meet you, Mizan, but Raven is only 17 years old and she has a curfew. Next time, we hope that you make sure she abides by it." Mizan looked at Raven in surprise when he found out she was only 17. "Little mama bad as hell," he thought, "but damn, she's jailbait." He nodded and replied, "No doubt. I didn't know she had a curfew. The next time we kick it, I'll make sure I have her home on time. Good night." Mizan headed back to his car. Benjamin nodded at Mizan, dismissing him without words. Raven couldn't help but smile because Mizan had clearly said that he was interested in seeing her again. She's stupid and young and high as fuck. Oh. Justine could see the attraction in her daughter's eyes. Mizan, Justine called out as she wrapped her silk robe tighter around her body. We don't let our daughter go out with just anyone. Why don't you stop by tomorrow so we can get to know you better? We're having a fish fry for our youngest daughter's birthday. Mizan nodded and winked at a blushing Raven while Benjamin turned to look at his wife like she was insane. Justine grabbed her husband's hand and led him into the house as Raven followed close behind. What were you doing in the inner city? Benjamin calmly asked his daughter once they were inside. He didn't have to raise his voice in order to express his anger. Raven could see his temple throbbing and his red, worried eyes made a streak of guilt run through her. I was just chilling, Daddy. I knew you wouldn't have let me go if I had asked you, Raven said in a baby's voice. She was a daddy's girl and hated for him to be upset with her. The look of disappointment he gave her made her want to cry. Yes, only fathers can double you up. Child, they fold you up like a fucking love letter, a prison love letter. All they gotta say is, I'm disappointed in you, Saki. I'm not mad. I'm just disappointed. You'd be like, oh my God, end it all. Oh my God. Then you come in here with that grown ass nigga. You're 17, Raven. You're still my baby girl. A nigga like that shouldn't even know where you rest your head. I taught you better than that, he said. He had to stop himself from speaking because he was too angry with her to control his emotions. She didn't understand the magnitude of her irresponsible actions. He had done a lot of dirt over the years. The makings of a boss required a lot of work, and he knew that he was the perfect target for a young nigga looking to come up. Having two daughters and a wife made it that much easier for him to be touched. They were his weakness, especially his beloved Raven. She was his firstborn, and he would catch a body if anything ever happened to her. He rubbed his stubby facial hair as he paced back and forth in the foyer. Raven stood before him with tears building in her eyes. He walked over to her and hugged her tightly, kissing the top of her head. I love you, Ray. I need you to understand that I'm just trying to keep you safe. There's no point to us living out here in the suburbs if you insist on going back to the hood every chance you get. I'm trying to save you from a lifestyle you can't handle. I want better for you than what I am. That little nigga you bought here tonight is too familiar. 20 years ago, that was me, and you deserve better than that. You deserve the world, Ray. Go and get some sleep. We got a busy day tomorrow. I want you up early to help your mama get ready for the party tomorrow. Right. She didn't need to be bringing that nigga home, because now he know where the king lay his head. That ain't cool. She didn't even know enough to pay attention to who was behind her. So she hit 90 on the highway, and he was behind her. She switching lanes and didn't even realize that somebody was following her. That's the quickest way to get to somebody. Catch they off guard, not paying attention family member. That's the quickest way. That's a little hood game for y'all. Teach your kids to be keep their head on a swivel and don't do dumb shit, especially if your shit ain't clean. Listen. Oh, Lord have mercy. This is gonna be bad because I got a feeling this nigga's on trash and now he know where she live and he don't give a fuck that she's 17. I'm already getting a headache. Her dad is Benjamin Atkins. He the dope man. The king of dope boys, apparently. Yeah. All right. Raven nodded and ascended the stairs. He should have slapped the shit out of her. That's what he should have done. He should have gave her a hot pocket upside her fucking face. That's what she needed. When she reached the top, she turned and said, Daddy, what's my punishment? Benjamin shook his head and sighed. He knew the day would come when a young nigga would come knocking at his door for his firstborn, but he hoped it would never be a nigga like Mizan. He wanted to lock her away and hide the key. If he could, he would keep her away from the world. He had never reprimanded her a day in her life. And although he wanted to, he wasn't going to today. As he looked up at her in disappointment, he said, You don't punish the ones you love, Ray. Remember that. Just don't let it happen again. Go to bed, princess. Child, spare the rod, spoil the child. I'd have beat her ass from the front to the back and a couple times. Wash, rinse, repeat. Don't bring nobody here. And if you got that nigga's number, call him and tell him to stay the fuck away from my address. Because if he do come by here, his whip is going to be lit up like the 4th of July. And I'm not playing that part. But, oh, Lord have mercy. This is going to be bad, y'all. All right. Oh, this is when you choke a booger out your child for being dumb. Raven gave her father a smile and headed to her room. When she passed her parents' bedroom, she noticed that her mother's light was still on. "Hey, mommy," she said as she peeked inside the room. "You like that boy, huh?" Justina asked as she patted the empty spot beside her. Raven sat down on the bed. Her infectious smile revealed her true feelings about Mizan. "He's cute," her mother said. "Now, how old did you tell him you were?" Raven didn't respond, and her mother continued. "Raven, he's not one of these little boys you got chasing behind you at your high school. He looks like he's at least 3 years older than you. I know what it's like to be your age and have all the older guys checking for you. It feels good to have the attention, but this boy has got a lot more game than you do, Ray. I'm not going to try to tell you who you can and cannot see. In a few months, you'll be 18, so I'll leave the decision up to you. But you need to be careful with him." "I will, Ma, I promise," Raven answered as she got up and headed to her room. "Oh, yeah, and Raven," her mother called, stopping her in her tracks. "Yeah, Mommy," she responded, turning around to look at her. "The next time you bring your ass in here high, I'm gonna beat the black off of you. Divas don't smoke. You leave that to the niggas. As long as you conduct yourself like a lady, then everyone around you will have to treat you like one. Also, Morgan looks up to you. She's your baby sister, and she's watching everything you do. She wants to be just like you. So you gotta show her how to be a lady the same way I showed you, understand?" her mother stated sternly, wisdom lacing her tone. Raven nodded her head and replied, "Yeah, Mommy, I understand. Now go take a shower and wash the smoke out of your hair before your father smells it on you," Justine instructed. She shook her head as she watched her daughter walk out of the room. "I swear that girl is too much like me when I was her age. I'm gonna have to keep a close eye on her. She thinks she grown, but I'm Queen Bee up in here with her little cute self," Justine thought with a smile while shaking her head. She couldn't help but think back to the day a hood fella came into her life. Back to the day when she got caught up in the love of her life, Benjamin Atkins. Now here we go. 1975. 16-year-old Justine Washington was a fly girl. In roller skates, a stonewashed miniskirt, and a halter top, she leaned against the banister of TLC skating rink while chit-chatting with her girlfriends as all the guys rolled by showing off. She was a beautiful distraction as her pretty long, freshly oiled legs shined underneath the colored strobe lights as she bobbed her head to the sounds of Parliament and Funkadelic. "Hey, Corey," she called out as the most popular guy in school went past her full speed. He turned his head and winked at her as he spun on his wheels, trying to impress her. He began to skate backward as they stared at each other while he did circles around her. Staring a moment too long at the most popular girl in school, he lost his balance and went ass first, falling to the floor. Justine and her girls cracked up as they turned and skated away. "Damn, Just. Girl, the boy gonna break his neck trying to get at you," her best friend Minnie exclaimed. Justine laughed as she commanded the skating rink as if she owned it. Her hips swayed from side to side as she raised her hands in the air, snapping her fingers to the beat. "Listen, why am I over here making the rock skate moves, okay?" Everybody who was anybody was there on the Saturday night when the 18 and up crowd commanded the club. With her grown-up looks and fake ID, she had gotten into the rink without a problem. She was easily the belle of the ball. Her infatuation with attention came from the lack of it she received at home. Her mother was a mean drunk who despised her daughter for taking the best years of her life. She blamed Justine for robbing her of her figure because after she gave birth, she went from a voluptuous size 12 to a sloppy 28. Listen, Linda. Who wrote this damn book? Because they must have been paying attention to my life, because okay, if that ain't me and my mama, listen, Linda. When her mother's sighs bounced, so did Justine's father. Well, my daddy didn't leave my mama, but she blew up child like the Goodyear blimp. He stayed right there, stuck sticking to her stubborn ass. Anyway, that's a whole nother story. All right. And now her mother was miserable, allowing man after man into her life to make her feel good. Most days, she acted as if Justine did not exist, which left Justine feeling alone in a world so cold. With an absentee father and a selfish mother, this left a huge void in her heart. So, any amount of attention she got was a good thing to her, which was why her skirts were always a little high and her blouses cut a little low to turn heads. Being center stage, Justine floated on four wheels like a professional when she noticed she had an audience. Hold on, y'all. Let me There we go. Let me get this volume right. All right. Dripping in gold and leaned up against the wall with one foot propped up sat Benny Atkins, the finest man she had ever seen. He was surrounded by an entourage of men, and as he stared at her coolly, she felt power emanating from him. His brown, smooth skin and bedroom eyes were attractive, and she gave him a flirtatious smile. She really got into her moves as Michael Jackson's new hit blared from the speakers. She could tell by his cockiness that he was a little bit older than she. Not once did his eyes leave hers, letting her know that he was definitely staring at something he liked. He nodded at her when the song ended. She skated away with her girls, hoping that she had piqued his interest and that he would try to approach her. But to her surprise, when she turned back to look, their thing had passed. He was kicking it with the fellas and entertaining the next pretty young thing who had crossed his path. This put her in a funk the rest of the night. She purposefully walked past him, switching her wide hips so hard that she thought she had popped them out of place, but to no avail. He didn't even notice, being too wrapped up in Big Booty Kima, the neighborhood freak. Not Kima, the neighborhood freak. Hold on now. Smacking her teeth, she turned to her girl Minnie and said, "This is lame. I'm out of here. You don't want to hang out in the parking lot? Come on, Just. You know that everybody's going to stick around for at least an hour," Minnie pleaded. "No, girl, I'm out. But you stay in groove. I'm right around the way, so I can walk home. Call me tomorrow," Justine said as she sat down to remove her skates. She hugged her best friend and headed out the door with the rest of the crowd. Dudes were already posted up outside waiting for the unofficial after party to begin. She got catcalls and "Hey, babies," as she made her way across the lot. On the dark Flint City streets, she strolled carelessly. The city was completely different during that time. Affluence from the General Motors shops kept the residents well-fed, and crime was a rare occurrence, so she didn't think twice about walking the 6 blocks to her crib. She was halfway home when the fear of what she may encounter when she arrived settled in. Her mother's bed was like a revolving door, and oftentimes the men invited inside had roaming eyes and hands. A creepy feeling crawled up her spine as she turned the corner to her street and saw the Chevy Caprice sitting in her driveway, letting her know that her mother was entertaining company. She was always left to fend for herself and had learned a long time ago that her mother was not her savior. Her mother's motto was that grown bitches took care of themselves. "Since you got tits and ass, use a grown bitch. You quit switching around here and my men might not want a taste," she had said the first time Justine had told her mother about one of her boyfriend's pedophiliac ways. She took a deep breath and used her key to open the door. Her heart skipped a beat when she saw her mother passed out in a liquor-induced coma while her company felt her up. Justine quickly tried to pass, but her path was blocked when her mother's guy friend arose from the couch. A lone tear graced her cheek when she noticed the lustful look filling the man's eyes. He was a new guy. She had never seen him before, but she had seen that look of desire many times. Her eyes fell to the floor. "Not again," she thought miserably, already knowing what was to come. Benny Atkins was the man in his city. Young, fly, and fresh, he was in his prime. Out for a night on the town, he had let his friends talk him into doing something he never did: relax. It was a celebration of sorts. Benjamin Benny Atkins had secured his first heroin connection, and he could only imagine the type of money he was about to come into. At 20 years old, he had the world in the palms of his hands. "I'ma show these niggas how to hustle, how to get this money," he thought as he crossed one shell-toe Adidas over the other and leaned on his brand new Cadillac DeVille. Not the DeVille, honey. Was it the Coupe DeVille? I'm sorry. There was only one man standing in his way, and that was Sherman Oaks, his old connect. Sherman was a washed-up hustler, a number man who had made the transition to heroin after seeing how much money there was to make during the Vietnam War. But he was a thorn in Benny's side. The old man didn't want to see the young hood star rise above him and had threatened Benny's life by putting a street contract on his head. Benny wasn't scared. He had mad love in his city, and he only had one mentality: hit Sherman before Sherman hit him. Get or get got. Yes, baby, that's the motto, get or get got. They had been playing a game of hide and seek with one another for weeks, but when his right-hand man whispered in his ear, "We know where he at," Benny knew that it was his lucky day. When they pulled up to the small, dilapidated one-story house, Benny ensured that his gun was loaded. "Keep the car running," he told one of his goons as he and his right-hand man, Wood, got out of the car. "We're in and out." Benny knew that the murder would not take long. He did not intend on making Sherman suffer. He wasn't about games, only gunplay. One shot to the head would get the job done, and then he would be gone like a thief in the night. "Please don't do this," she begged as she tried to pull her shirt out of his grasp. "Mom," she called out. Her cries were useless. Her mother was so far gone from the liquor that she could not awaken until after she slept it off. "Bitch, shut up and take this dick. Consider it a blessing," he said, as he backhanded her so hard it sent her flying to the floor. Justine scooted away from him as she held her face, feeling the gash that his watch had made as hot, salty tears burned the wound. She shook her head and backed up until her back hit the wall. "Please," she sobbed. She watched him look down at her devilishly as he removed his belt and unbuttoned his pants. He removed his gun and placed it near his pants and got down on the floor, grabbing her legs forcefully as she tried to kick him off. "No," she yelled, terrified. "Mama, wake up." "Yeah, I bet you this young pussy tight," he said lustfully as he began to kiss her neck, ignoring her desperate pleas. The scent of him made her stomach turn as her fist beat his chest in protest. He pried her young legs open, forcing them so far apart that pain shot through her lower back. She brought her knee up as hard as she could to his groin, but he moved just in time. "Look, bitch, be still," he yelled as he grabbed her head and slammed it as hard as he could against the floor. Justine saw stars as her head fell to the side. Disoriented, she couldn't fight back as bells went off in her head. She could feel his hard penis at her opening as tears trailed her cheeks and graced the floor. "Please, God, let him be quick," she prayed as she reached out in a desperate attempt to save herself. Benny Atkins kicked in the door and rushed in with his gun aimed, ready to hit anything moving. "What the fuck?" Sherman cried out as he turned around to see Benny standing behind him. He had been caught in the worst way with his pants down. "Fuck you doing, old man?" Wood asked in disgust as he looked at Justine sprawled out across the floor crying. Benny instantly recognized the girl as the fresh chick from the skating rink, and he trained his pistol on Sherman. "You like little girls, my nigga?" he asked. "Nah, Benny, you know how it is. I was just having a little fun, player," Sherman said nervously as he pulled up his underwear. "Don't look like she having too much fun," Benny said, his eyes turning dark with every word he spoke. "Help her up, Wood," he instructed. Justine was crying so hard that she couldn't get up from the floor, all the while her mother laying clueless on the couch. She felt Wood scoop her in his arms and help her stand. "Come on, man. You can have the streets, Benny. Just put the gun down. I taught you everything you know, man. Return the favor and put the gun away." Sherman spoke fast so he could buy himself some time. Benny nodded his head and replied, "I tell you what, if baby girl say you can live, then you'll live. If not," before Benny could finish his sentence, gunshots rang out of the house. Boom, 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 boom. Justine had grabbed Sherman's gun and shot him without thinking twice. Her hands shook violently, but the hatred in her eyes let Benny know that she had been hurt many times before and she had just made Sherman pay for it with his life. Benny walked up to her cautiously and wrapped his hand around the smoking gun. After he removed it from her hand, she collapsed into his chest, sobbing. "It's all right. Everything's okay," Benny soothed. He nodded to his man and passed him the murder weapon. Wood opened his eyes wide as if to say, "Shorty ain't playing." He took the gun and knew that he was supposed to perform a magic trick by making it disappear. Benjamin began to walk away, leaving Justine crying and holding herself as she stared at the dead man on her living room floor, but his gut wouldn't let him leave her there like that. When he turned around, he noticed how beautiful she was. In such a delicate state, she needed it. She was like a leaf hanging on to a limb. The winds of life were threatening to blow her away. She needed him. She needed him to stabilize her life, to be her root, her new beginning, her everything. He could sense it in her eyes. Justine was the lady for him. He walked back over to her and removed his coat, wrapping it around her quivering body. "Is there somewhere I can take you?" he asked. She looked up at him with desperate eyes and shook her head. She had no one. It had just been her for as long as she could remember. Even with the presence of her mother, she always felt lonely. No one cared. All she had was herself and a mind full of painful memories that made life seem unbearable. He looked around at the tiny house and at her deadbeat mother. There was no way he could leave her there. "You're coming with me. I'm gonna make sure you're all right," he asserted. He scooped her into his arms and Wood opened the door for them as they made their exit. It was the last time that Justine never saw her mother. She kissed her old life goodbye. Benjamin made good on his promise and made sure that Justine was okay. He fell in love with her instantly, and as he rose to the top of the game, So did she. He made her tell him the names of every man who had ever brought her harm, and mysteriously, they all had gruesome misfortunes, meeting their fate earlier than they had anticipated at the hands of an upcoming wood legend. He wanted her to know that as long as he was around, she had no one to fear. Her life was butter from that day forward. He made her his world and the queen of the streets. Justine wiped the tears from her eyes as she snapped out of her daydreams. Her husband, Raven's father, had saved her life. Before him, she had not known what love was. Now she had two beautiful daughters and anything she could ever want. She had given her life to a hustler, so she knew what it took to be the dope man's lady. And as she reminisced on everything they had been through together, she was positive that Raven was not ready to live the life. She thinks she's ready, but she's not. She's just a baby. My baby, Justine thought. She did not want the lifestyle of the hood for her daughter. Everything about Mizan spelled H-U-S-T-L-E-R. Yeah, I have to keep my eye on her. Niggas ain't the same no more. They don't make hustlers like Benny anymore. She deserves so much more. Justine shook old memories from her thoughts and turned off her bedroom light, retiring for the night. And that's the end of that chapter. Yes, indeed, child. This is, that was a 40-minute chapter. Listen. Oh my goodness, child. I like it so far. What y'all think? That was chapter one. Y'all know I try to get into chapter three. But what y'all think about chapter one? I like Benny. I tell you that. I like Benny. I don't like Mizan because he a creep stain. But I definitely like her daddy. Benny could get it. But that damn Mizan would catch a metal fade fucking with me. Mm-mm. All right, so let me get my time stamp together. Did y'all like the video? Okay, so Kay says she liking so far. All right, all right, all right. We're good. I'm glad. Who? Yeah, Benny could get it. Yeah, I mean, you know, back in the day, Benny. He old now. Y'all know I don't want nobody my age. Child, fuck out of here. Mm-mm. No. And he old as shit because she was 16 in 1975. So, you know, right about now, that means he at least 10 years older than me. Or, well, what? Yeah, no. Shit, he 15 years older than me. Well, how old was Benny? Was he 20? Because he was 20 and she was 16, right? Mm-hmm. Yeah. So in 75, he was 20. Child, that mean he 15 years older than me. Hell no. That nigga 69. No, man. I ain't gonna be able to do it. Nope. That's old meat. I don't want old meat. I don't like old meat. Do you buy old ass steak from the store? No, you don't. I don't buy old. Anyway. Nobody wants old pain, okay? Except for old women. And I ain't old. So now, make of that what you will, okay? All right. Now let me wet my whistle, child. Chapter 2. The next day, the Atkins brought the hood to their prestigious affluent community as all of the hustlers in Benjamin's circle came out to show him love at Morgan's birthday cookout. His youngest daughter was deaf, so he always went above and beyond to make her feel as included and loved as possible. It was something they did annually for her, and somehow every single year, the children's party transformed into an adult party. Well, ain't that always what it is? Hell, every child's party I ever went to, the actual party for the kid lasted about an hour, and then after that, the adult's party for at least the next 6 hours. Shit. Mm-mm. Ain't nothing changed. Nothing. All right. Raven and Nikki were both wearing swimsuit tops and shorts that left nothing to the imagination. It was unusually hot outside as the sun blazed brightly. Michigan didn't normally warm up until late June, but as Raven watched her little sister and the rest of the kids splashing around in the pool, she was anxious to sit around in her bikini and enjoy the beautiful day. Everybody in the backyard came from nothing, but they were now working with legit businesses while holding rein over the city streets, all thanks to the leadership of Benjamin. Benjamin was the king, and the hustlers, along with their wives and children, were the courtship of his kingdom. "What did your dad say when you came in last night?" Nikki asked nosily. "He was mad, but he's over it now. My mama invited Mizan to the party. I don't know if he's going to show up, though. I haven't heard from him yet. I don't know if he'll call, because my mama threw salt in the game when she told him my real age," Raven explained. "Ray, you and Nikki come in here and grab some of this food. Y'all ain't just about to be standing around looking. You come help me," Justine called out to the pair. They went and grabbed the silver pans of side dishes that Justine had whipped up and carried them outside. Liquor flowed freely and the smell of weed was poking in the air as old school music played inside the house. They may have lived in lavish luxury, but there was nothing snobbish about the royal family. The scent of soul food permeated the air while the sound of dominoes being smashed on the tabletops resounded throughout the backyard. Benjamin and Justine kept it all the way real, all the time. They were good peoples and enjoyed the family environment as they celebrated their youngest child. They all felt safe because there were no outsiders in their club. Trust was at 100% among the men, so they each felt comfortable, so much so that Benjamin allowed everyone let loose and enjoy the party without putting men on post to guard his home. It was all love because everyone in attendance had pledged their allegiance to Benjamin and vice versa. "Raven, come over here. I want you to meet somebody," Benjamin called out. "Damn, who is that?" Nikki commented as she lifted her hand to block the sun so she could get a better view. Raven turned in the direction of her father and lifted her sunglasses when she saw the same dude she had seen the night before at the corner store. "I don't know, but I'm about to find out," she told her friend as she placed her glasses on top of her head and walked over to her father. "Ethic, this is my daughter Raven. Ray, this is Ethic. He works for me," Benjamin stated. Before they could say anything to each other, Justine called Benjamin into the house. "Ray, go to the store and grab some more ice for the coolers." "I'm blocked in," she yelled. Benjamin pointed to Ethic. "Ethic will take you. He's new in town. It'll give you a chance to get acquainted." "So you're from Missouri?" Raven asked, making small talk as she and Ethic walked to the front yard. He nodded as he led her to his car and opened the passenger door for her. She hopped in and then slid over into the driver's seat. When he made it around to the driver's side, she held her hand out. "I'll drive," she stated with a smile. He opened the door and said, "A little girl like you can't handle my whip, Mom. Scoot over." "Oh, I can handle it just fine. I've ridden bigger things," she insinuated, not moving an inch. Oh, Lord have mercy. She a whole mess. "What you don't want your little girlfriend from yesterday to see me driving your car? No offense, but somebody like you needs to upgrade. I would think you would have a better bitch on your arm," Raven said bluntly. Ethic scoffed and shook his head at her slick comment. "You should clean up that mouth of yours," he said as he handed her the keys. He got into the passenger side as Raven started the car. She pulled away from the curb. "Don't wreck my shit, Mom. This will drive itself." "All you got to do is steer," he instructed as he leaned back in his seat. "I got you. I'm not going to tear up your car," she stated as she eased into traffic. "So, was that your girl you were talking to yesterday?" she asked. "No, that wasn't my lady," he replied. "So, do you have a chick?" He laughed as he adjusted his fitted cap, pulling it so low on his head that it almost covered his mysterious eyes. "You ask a lot of questions," he said. "Why are you so interested in me? I'm a grown man. Don't you have little high schoolers or something checking for you?" "Yeah, but I'm not worried about them. I'm checking for you," she admitted. "Nah, you checking for old boy you were with last night," he shot back. "That whole ass nigga, you should watch the type of company you keep." She smacked her lips and looked at him out of the corner of her eye. "What, you were jealous?" "You wild, Ma," he said as he shook his head at her persistence. He gazed out of the window as they rode through the ruthless city. "I saw you watching me," she said after they reached the store and parked. She turned in her seat to face him. "That was before," he said. "Before what?" she asked. "Before you opened your mouth to speak. You a youngin', Ma. You don't know shit about the world around you. You pushing grown woman whips and walking grown woman clothes." He tapped her temple gently as he leaned close to her. "But up here, you're still a baby." "Boy, boo," she replied curtly with a flip of her hand. "I'm a grown-ass woman. I'm gonna be 18 in a few months," she stated, as if that made her an adult. "How old are you?" 22. You can be my old head, she replied flirtatiously. Admit it, all the rest of these busted bitches ain't what you into. I'm the only girl that's gonna look good on your arm. That's the problem, shorty. I'm not looking for a girl. I want a woman, and you're not there yet. He exited the car, leaving Raven with heavy thoughts on her mind. Mizan sat in his car with his automatic pistol lying in his lap as he watched people go in and out of the Atkins home. When he had originally laid eyes on Raven, he had no clue that she was the daughter of Flint's largest kingpin. His jackboy status kept him in the grimiest parts of the hood, places where Raven would never frequent. They were two individuals living in the same city, but their perceptions of Flint were drastically different. She sat at the top and looked down on the minions who inhabited the murder capital, whereas he was at the bottom, clawing his way up inch by inch. Because of their differences in age and hood status, their paths had never crossed before. But all of that changed when the naive young girl walked into a small club on his side of town. Now that he knew who she was associated with, she was even more appealing to him. Just from being in her presence, he had discovered what not many people knew, Benny Atkins' home address. It was a stick-up kid's dream to be able to get inside of the infamous drug dealer's home, and because of Raven, he had been extended a personal invitation. He was not about to take the chance of a lifetime for granted. He had his man, Bull, and his brother, Boo, lurking in a parked car few blocks away with black masks and black gloves, just waiting for the word from Mizan to run up in the house. I know that motherfucker could keep us safe at this crib, Mizan thought as he studied the home, watching friends of the family as they laughed and joked with one another. He, on the other hand, wasn't there to socialize. After finding out Raven's age, he had thought of dismissing her. He didn't fuck with young chicks. The headaches they caused weren't worth the unexplored crevices between their thighs. But Raven was different. She was hood royalty, a sheltered daughter who wanted to be down, and he was about to put her on his team. He knew that it would be easy to capture her head. She was young and impressionable. She would be easy for him to mold. It was the number one rule of any nigga trying to lock down a loyal chick. Fuck a bitch's mind and the body will follow, Mizan thought, remembering what his deceased father had taught him when he was coming into adolescence. Mizan could see that Raven was in love with her father. Just from the small time he had seen them interacting, it was obvious that he was the king of her world. Mizan fully intended to break that bond. He wanted Raven for himself. On top of being the flyest little diva in the city, she was his meal ticket. He wanted her on his team. Her loyalty was about to shift from her father to her new daddy, which was why he had gone out of his way to show up to the little shindig. He saw the black truck that whipped around the corner and noticed Raven sitting behind the wheel. Fuck is this motherfucker she rolling with? He thought, puzzled. He took the safety off his pistol and tucked it in his waistband as he exited the car. He leaned against his car as he watched Raven park the vehicle on the curb. When she got out, he noticed that she was frowned up as if she had just got out of a heated discussion. But then she finally saw him. Her frown easily melted away. You came, she said, surprised, her voice rising an octave. She walked across the street to him and hugged him as if she hadn't seen him in years. Mizan embraced her, whapping. I can't even talk. I'm so pissed off that she's so fucking dumb. I'm sorry, y'all. Okay, wrapping one arm around her small waist as he kissed her neck. What, you thought I would? He replied as he leaned against his car with his hands tucked in his pockets. He wore baggy Sean John jeans and a pale yellow designer polo with fresh kicks. The waves in his fresh cut left her dizzy. He was clean and looked even better than the day before. Even Raven couldn't believe that she had fooled him. I thought when you found out how old I was, you would crap out, she stated truthfully. When do you turn 18? He asked. In August? Then I guess we'll have to keep this thing friendly until then. Know what I mean? He licked his lips and looked down at her. He couldn't believe that the beautiful body before him belonged to a girl so young, but he appreciated it all the same. His eyes roamed her scantily clad body, and he shook his head at the lovely sight. He glanced up the street and could see his goons obediently waiting to hear the word. We can head to the back. Are you hungry? We got all kinds of food, Raven said as she led the way. When Mizan walked past Benjamin, he nodded in acknowledgement. He could feel her father's eyes suspiciously trying to figure him out, but Raven was oblivious to it all. First of all, you don't walk past the man of the house without saying, good afternoon, sir. Thank you so much for allowing me to attend your shindig. I truly appreciate you, right? And then you find the woman of the house and do the same thing. You give her a hug, and you should have some fucking flowers for her and a bottle in your hand for the pappy, right? That's old school. Even though he ain't gonna respect your ass no way, because you trying to fuck his daughter, it don't matter. It don't hurt to, like, grease the wheels a little bit. Like, you just a grimy ass nigga. Anyway, he ain't never had nobody show him the ropes. Fuck him. She beamed as she walked around proudly on his arm. Justine watched her daughter and Mizan interact. She could see that Raven was into him, and she could also see that her husband wasn't fond of the idea at all. She walked over to him and placed her hand on his back. Stop frowning, Benny. She's 17. At least they're here at the house where we can keep an eye on them, she reasoned. Benjamin nodded and kissed her cheek, but his frown never wavered. He watched as Mizan whispered in Raven's ear and his blood boiled. He motioned for Ethic to come over to him. I want you to do me a favor, young blood. Keep an eye on that nigga over there with my daughter. I don't like how he moved. Something about him ain't right, Benjamin said. We're reading out of the same book, fam. I'll keep an eye out, Ethic assured as he sat back and observed while slowly sipping a Heineken. I like Ethic already. Okay. And he chocolatey too? I guess he chocolatey. Didn't she say he was black? Yes. Sorry. Raven may not have sensed the shade in Mizan, but Real recognized Real, and everything about him spelled phony to Ethic. Even the way he interacted with Raven seemed rehearsed, as if he had his mind on other things. Little did Ethic know, Mizan had his eyes on robbing Benny Atkins. Mizan wasn't focused on anything but taking mental notes of his surroundings. He noticed that the only time someone went inside the house was to use the bathroom. Other than that, the inside was off limits. It was the perfect setup. While everybody was partying and distracted out back, Mizan was about to hit the inside. He knew that his crew would have to get in and out. As he looked around at all the hustlers and street legends in attendance, he knew that they were strapped. If anything went wrong, there would be no turning back. What he was trying to do was reckless, but the life and times of a jack boy often were. It was all or nothing. Mizan was ready to make his move. Yo, you got a restroom I can use, he asked. Yes, it's right inside. Go through the back door. It's the first door on your left, Raven instructed. As soon as he got inside the house, he walked around, making sure the coast was clear. After discovering that no one was in the house, he quickly unlocked the front door and then headed back to the party. As he sat back down next to Raven, he pulled out his phone. The front door is unlocked. In and out like a robbery, my niggas. Grab jewelry, money, product. Everything else is too big to carry out of the house unnoticed. Try to find the safe. You're having a good time? Raven asked. Mizan nodded and replied, it's not my type of scene, but I know I gotta put in time with your folk. Raven's little sister ran up to her soaking wet and wrapped her arms around her big sister's waist. Raven, is this your boyfriend? Morgan asked through sign language, smiling. She can't hear? Mizan asked. Nah, she's been deaf since she was born, Raven informed him. What does she say? He asked. She wants to know if you're my man, Raven said with a smirk, putting him on the spot. Get out of here. She didn't ask you that shit, he laughed. I swear, Raven stated as she laughed too. He smiled and bent down so that he was eye level with Morgan. She was the spitting image of Raven. She can read your lips, so you can talk to her. I'm her friend, Mizan. What's your name? Morgan Jacqueline Atkins, she signed proudly, then patted her cheeks as if she were putting on makeup. It was the sign that Raven had made up for her name when she was just a baby. Her name is Morgan, Raven interpreted. Mizan pulled a $20 bill out of his pocket and handed it to Morgan. Happy birthday. Six-year-old Morgan looked at the money in her hands and frowned. You don't have anything bigger than Andrew? She sighed, revealing her spoiled nature. She had been raised among the hood's elite and was used to them showering her with big face bills whenever they came around. Raven relayed the message, and Mizan looked at the mini diva, shaking his head. I got you, shorty. He removed a 50 and handed it to her. Is that better? She smiled brightly and nodded her head. She then tucked the 20 and the $50 bills inside her swimsuit. Thank you, she signed. Raven just shook her head and chuckled, knowing that her little sister had hustled almost $100 out of Mizan. I know that's right, little diva. Get that paper. The fuck you thought? You gonna come over to my crib, eat my parents' food, and give me 20 funky-ass dollars and no card? Nigga boo. Uh-uh. You $80 short, motherfucker. Bust out the hundo or get the fuck gone. Mm-hmm. Anyway, okay. Can you go play now, Morgan? Raven said. No, mommy told me to tell you to help me get dressed. I'm tired of swimming. I want to put on my birthday outfit, she replied, her hands moving quickly to let Raven know that she wanted to change now. No exceptions. Raven sighed and looked at Mizan. She's such a brat. I'll be right back, she said, then grabbed Morgan's hand and led her into the house. As Mizan saw Raven disappear inside the house, he quickly took out a cell phone, hoping that his goons hadn't already entered. Ah! When he heard the ear-piercing scream, he closed his eyes in regret, knowing that it was too late. Fuck, he muttered, knowing that the shit was about to hit the fan. Justine dropped the plate of food she had in her hand and instantly began running full speed toward the house. Benjamin, she screamed, knowing that something was wrong with her daughters. Benjamin and an entire army of hustlers rushed toward the house, including Epic, who entered first, pistol in hand. He was ready to shoot anything moving. When he entered, he saw a crying Morgan and Raven in the hands of three masked men. Epic, Raven screamed as she tried to lunge for him, but as she was restrained in a chokehold. Morgan cried when her father came into view, reaching out as she opened her mouth in fear. Oh my God, Justine cried when she saw what was happening. Get the fuck back before I blow this bitch brains all over the floor, one of the intruders yelled. Raven closed her eyes as tears streamed down her face. Her captor had a gun firmly planted against her temple. She braced herself, preparing for the worst, as she shook like a leaf in the wind. The sounds of her little sister's cries tormented her. Benjamin's trigger finger itched as he stood in front of his army of lieutenants. Everyone in the room was strapped, but he knew that even if one shot was fired, then his two beautiful daughters would be dead. He stepped up next to Ethic and put his hands up. Everybody calm down. All I want are my daughters. Everything else, you can take with you. Benjamin tried to conceal the malice in his voice as he stood not even 5 feet from the masked intruders. Ethic fell back into the crowd and grabbed Justine by the shoulders, ushering her back outside. You don't need to see what's about to go down in there, he whispered. Stay out here. No matter what you hear, do not come in. I'ma handle it. Justine nodded as she grabbed his shirt. Ethic, they're my babies. I know, he said, as he sat her down in the lawn chair. He ran to the front yard and noticed Mizan's car pulling away from the house. He made a mental note of it. The nigga girl is in there at gunpoint and he disappearing, Ethic thought, suspicious. Hearing a loud scream come from the house, he knew he didn't have time to press the issue. Putting his suspicions of Mizan in his mental file, he refocused as he approached the front door. He pulled a .38 out of his ankle holster, and with a pistol in each hand, he crept up onto the porch. He could see Benjamin through the screen door, and he put his finger to his lips to signal for him to keep his cool. Morgan, Raven, everything is going to be okay. Close your eyes, Benjamin said in both sign language and aloud as he stepped closer to the intruders, his hands still raised in the air. He made eye contact with Ethic, who nodded and aimed his two pistols at the two men who had the girls. Morgan's wide eyes indicated her terror. She wet herself from the overwhelming fear. Raven just did as she was told. Didn't I say back the fuck? Pow, pow, pow. Before the intruder could get the words out of his mouth, Ethic introduced a hollow point to his brain, shooting both men simultaneously. Before Benjamin could even speak, the third gunman looked like Swiss cheese as his goons let their cannons bark. The bodies dropped instantly, and blood covered Raven and young Morgan. Raven put her hands over her mouth to stifle her cries as she rocked back and forth. Justine ran into the house and rushed over to her daughters. You're okay, baby, you're okay, she whispered gratefully as she picked Morgan up while Benjamin wrapped his arms around their eldest child. Nikki burst through the crowd and fell to the floor to embrace Raven. She cried with her best friend as they both thought of how close death had been. Fuck did they get in here? Benjamin shouted in outrage as he turned to the men in the room. How did they know where I live? He leaned into Ethic, shook his hand, embracing him slightly. He was especially grateful to him. Take my wife and kids someplace safe. I have to find out who was behind this and get these bodies out of here, Benjamin said. He walked over to Justine and told her that she would be leaving with Ethic. She nodded and carried her daughter out of the house. Ethic turned to Raven, who was still holding on to Nikki for dear life. He watched as Benjamin approached her. Baby girl, I need you to be strong for Daddy. You're going to go with Ethic, he said. No, I want to stay here with you. She couldn't stop the tears from flowing down her cheeks, and the only place she felt safe was in her father's presence. You can't, Ray. You can't stay here. Not tonight. Trust me, baby girl. Ethic will take care of you. Just go with him. He hugged her tightly and then walked away. Call me and let me know you're okay, Nikki whispered in her ear as she hugged her one last time. Raven nodded. Then Ethic put his hand on the small of her back and led her to his car. She was silent as she watched the city streets pass, and she rubbed her sister's hair gently, trying to ease her soul. Her head was spinning, and no matter how hard she tried, she couldn't restore her tough girl visage. When the car stopped moving, she looked up and noticed that they were at a house, but nice, modest. She opened the car door and stepped out without speaking. Her bloody clothes felt disgusting on her body and made her want to throw up. She felt her mouth water and she inhaled deeply to stop herself from becoming sick. Ethic welcomed them into his three-bedroom tri-level home. He set them up in his spare rooms, allowing Justine and Morgan to sleep together. Thank you, Ethic. My husband speaks very highly of you, and after what you did today, I can see exactly what he says is true, Justine said. I'm going to put Morgan to bed, but I want to let you know that I appreciate you allowing us to stay here for the night. Not a problem. Let me know if you need anything, he said. He turned to Raven, who stood in the hallway, and pointed to the room across the hall. You can sleep in here. He stood in the doorway as he watched Raven in front of the dresser mirror. She looked at the blood covering her shirt and her hands began to shake. There are clothes in the drawer and towels in the closet. The bathroom's down the hall, he said. She nodded but said nothing as she watched him leave the room. She grabbed the towels and headed for the bathroom. As she stepped into the shower, her tears mixed with the water and she lowered her head so that it could run through her hair. She closed her eyes and put her hands on the shower walls. This was the first time she realized that the streets were not a game. There was more to them than the glitz and glamour. She had almost lost her life, and that fact shook her to the core, causing her stomach to turn. She'd never seen a dead body before, and flashes of the men lying with their brains leaking onto the floor plagued her. She just couldn't get the images out of her head. She jumped out of the shower and wrapped a towel around her as she felt vomit tickling her throat. She leaned over the toilet and heaved violently, her nerves bringing up everything that she'd eaten that day. She hugged the toilet as she sank to the floor. A knock at the door caused her to wipe her eyes. She hated to seem like a child, so she grabbed a tissue to soak up her tears as Ethic's voice echoed through the door. Raven, everything all right? He asked. No, everything's not all right, she thought. He opened the door and saw her sitting on the floor. She stood up as he came in and closed the door. You okay? He asked. She simply nodded because she knew that if she spoke, her floodgates would fail her. Her wet hair hung on her face, made her shiver as she stood in front of Ethic. I thought they were going to kill me, she whispered, her eyes distant, as if she was recalling everything in her mind. He put his hand on her neck and massaged it gently as he stared at her empathetically. But they didn't. But they could have, she responded quickly. He shook his head. I would not have let that happen. She fell into her chest. Oh, sorry. She fell into his chest. How'd she fall into her own chest, Saki? Damn. Okay. She fell into his chest and sobbed uncontrollably. Ethic fought with himself, trying to decide if he should hold her, but as he listened to her weep, he realized this was the real Raven, a weak and vulnerable girl who wasn't ready for the lifestyle she so desperately wanted to lead. He wrapped his arms around her and allowed her to release her fear. She was trembling, and he thought that her knees might give out beneath her. Scooping her in his arms, he carried her into the spare room. Her eyes were red and puffy as he lay her in the bed. I don't want to sleep, she whispered. You're safe here. I'll be right here next to you, he promised, as he took a seat in the chair next to the bed. He sat facing toward her and leaned down over her as if he was tucking her in. He ran his hand over her face. Close your eyes, Raven, he whispered. I'm not going anywhere. Raven awoke the next day to an empty room. Looking at the clock, she noticed that it was only 6 in the morning. She arose from the bed and walked out into the hallway. She could hear noise coming from somewhere in the house, and she paused mid-step, listening closely. She crept toward the kitchen and realized that the noise was coming from the basement. She crept down the steps, her bare manicured feet sinking into the plush carpet. She stopped when she saw, a shirtless Ethic. Ooh, describe it, please. Lifting weights in the basement, his toned chest glistened with sweat as he gritted his teeth while pressing the weights above his head. Raven was in awe as she watched every muscle of his body bulge. Her mouth was wide open as she enjoyed the show. He was the sexiest man she had ever seen in her life. Her attraction to him was more than a schoolgirl crush. She loved him, and she didn't even know his last name. Ethic put the weights on their stand and sat up to find her staring at him. Embarrassment flushed her face, but neither of them said a word. He turned his back on her and continued his routine as if she weren't standing there. I wanted to know if you had heard from my daddy, she said as she leaned against the wall. He called late last night. I'll be taking you back home when your moms wake up, he said through clenched teeth as he curled the free weights, working his biceps. Raven continued to stand there as her eyes roamed his body. He stopped and turned toward her, breathing hard from exhaustion. Yes, we like to exhaust, don't we? Did you want something else? He asked in an annoyed tone. Yes, that dick. Sorry. Raven was at a loss for words. Maybe she wanted to lick the sweat from his muscles. Good googly moogly. Calm down, Saki. Of course she wanted something else. She wanted him. The way he had protected her last night reminded her of her father. He was perfect for her, and he didn't even know it. She tried to find the courage to tell him how she felt, but she knew that words couldn't express how she was feeling. She walked up on him slowly, almost timidly, afraid of how he was going to react to what she was about to do. There weren't too many people who intimidated her, but Ethic did. He made her nervous, and as she stood in front of him, her heart beat out of her chest. She closed her eyes and went for it, standing on the tips of her toes to kiss him. Ethic stepped back and pushed her away gently, but with enough authority to let her know that she had overstepped her boundaries. I did what I did yesterday out of the respect I have for your pops. It had nothing to do with you, he said truthfully. His words stung, insulting her and embarrassing her at the same time. Feeling stupid, Raven scoffed and rolled her eyes as she put her hands on her hips. Nothing to do with me, she repeated in disbelief. I'm not buying that. I don't know a nigga in the world who would catch a body over somebody they didn't give a damn about. Let me make this real clear for you, little girl. I don't have time for you. I already got a lady in my life, and I don't have love for no female but her. She has my heart. All of it. You could never compete with her, he said, before turning his back on her. Somebody pass Raven a broom so she could sweep up the fragments of her face that have shattered on the Nigga! He didn't shut her down. He shut her down all the way. Pushed her down to the earth's core so she could sizzle like bacon in a skillet on Sunday morning. Child, she burning up. Raven shook her head in dismay as she walked back up the steps, enraged and near tears. She couldn't wait to get out of Ethic's presence. She had never been shot down like that before, and it bruised her ego, making her feel like she was lacking something that the next chick had. She did not know that what she was feeling was inadequacy. If she were really as grown up as she claimed to be, no man, not even Ethic, would be able to shatter her confidence. Poise could not be broken so easily in a real woman, and her salty disposition over Ethic proved that she was trying to grow up too fast. If she paced herself, she would eventually flourish into that woman, but she had a long way to go. She was missing all of the qualities that it took to be the type of woman Ethic would be attracted to. He was not the average hustler. He wasn't married to the streets like most young men his age. He knew that selling poison to his own people was wrong, and he promised himself that when he made his first million, he would exit the game and go legit. His focus was on his hustle, nothing more and nothing less, which was why it would take more than Raven's pretty face to distract him. When Raven returned to her house, everything was cleaned up and restored as if none of it had ever really happened. She hugged her father tightly, and he told her to go wait for him in his office. He came in and closed the door, then took a seat behind his mahogany desk. Stress was written all over his face. It seemed as though he had aged overnight. Deep lines of worry creased his forehead, and bags rimmed his stern red eyes. His heart was heavy at the fact that his beautiful family had been in harm's way. He was fully aware that in the blink of an eye, he could have lost everything. The silence in the room was deafening to Raven. She hated when her father got like this. The anticipation of not knowing what was on his mind was killing her. She leaned over and pinched the bridge of his nose. Oh, sorry, he leaned over and did that. Sorry. As he took a deep breath, I don't want you to see that boy again. If I even see him around our home, it's not going to be good for him, Benjamin said in a low but clear tone. What? Daddy, why not? What does Mizan have to do with any of this? She asked. I'm not sure that he has anything to do with it, but he was the only outsider here yesterday. I've never had anyone foolish enough to run inside my home. All of a sudden, when this kid shows up, three men in masks appear, put my family in danger. I don't believe in coincidences, Raven. You are not to see him again, Benjamin stated. But Daddy, Raven whined, he was next to me the entire time. This is not up for debate, Raven, Benjamin replied sternly. The nigga is bad news, and I don't want you around him. I can't be held responsible for my actions if I see him again. So I advise you to not disobey me. If you do, his blood will be on your hands. And that's the end of that chapter. So apparently, Benjamin didn't grab nobody's cell phone, and none of his goons and lieutenants and soldiers grabbed anybody's cell phones to look and read the text messages. No, nobody did any of that. Because that's what you do before you even move the bodies. When you cap niggas in your crib, give them a lead part, if you will, push their minds to the right from the left-hand side. When you do shit like that, the first thing you do is hit them pockets. First of all, you take all this shit. And then you check their phones and see who the fuck they've been talking to, commiserating with, chewing the fat with, kicking the Willy Bobo with. You check all of that. That's how you find out who's behind this shit. And then you go and Swiss cheese the motherfucker that gave them the instructions. That would be Mizan. Of course, then we wouldn't have a story if Mizan got Swiss cheesed in chapter two, right? But this story marches on. Anyway, I don't even know what to say. Yes. Thank you, Kay. I was thinking the same thing. Epic is midnight and Raven is winter. That's exactly what I was thinking. That instantly took me back to the coldest winter ever with winter trying to seduce midnight. And he like, little bitty bitch, if you don't go on somewhere, okay, little girl, run off and find you somebody, okay? Right. Definitely. That is exactly the vibe I got. Yep. That's he is midnight. Ethic is midnight. All right. Because he like, Shaw, you ain't ready for this. Hey, Kim Cash, you late, but you here working and listening. All right, boo, thank you so much for being here. I appreciate you. Yes, yes, yes. Glad you are in the building. Yes, Marva, he was casing the house, child. Didn't even get a fucking plate or a drink. Just start casing the place. Just an old hood nigga. A stick-up kid, child. You know they don't wait. He had formulated that plan from the moment he found out who her daddy was. Yep. Uh-oh. Hey, Ms. Dimples, welcome, darling. Thank you so much for being here. I appreciate you. Welcome, welcome. Okay, listen, child. If you think that's child, you should have heard me when I was reading that Stolen by a Billionaire and the Valentine Brothers, child. Listen. Ooh, that damn Hunter Valentine. And the Rose Brothers, child. Good googly moogly. All right. Yes, he left when all the shit happened. When everybody went in the house, he dipped out, just like old snake ass nigga. Yes, they got killed. They got killed in the house, Marvel. Yep. They got wet up, child. We like it. Mm-hmm. They got some nice warm metal parts in their fades, child. Yes, indeed. So, all right. Thank you, Kay, for liking the video. I appreciate you. All right. So, let me get this next time stamp, y'all, because I told y'all I'm trying to be done, stop this video at the 2 hour mark. So, we got 23 chapters and an epilogue. I ain't got time to be up here jaw jacking y'all. I got to be reading. I got to be reading like I'm late studying for a test. Chapter 3. It had been a long time since Benjamin had put in work of his own. Murder had been his game as a young kid, but as a distinguished head of a ruthless Midwest drug connection, he now had people to carry out his homicidal intent. As he looked into Raven's room and watched her sleeping peacefully, he knew it was time to get his feet wet again. All right now, Pops, wet them feet up and a few niggas right along with it. I know that's right. Get it, get it. All right. This was a situation that he had to handle personally. Sending one of his workers would not get the message across. He had to make the city bleed. The Jack boys who had invaded his home had already been taken care of, but now it was time to make an example by touching everyone who was associated with them, including women and children. Listen, Linda. The devil had lain dormant in him for too long, and now niggas around him thought shit was sweet. For one night, he was about to reveal his cold heart and make the city bleed. Tears came to his eyes, and he willed them away before closing Raven's door. After checking on his wife and youngest daughter, he said a short prayer asking God to watch over his family and left the house. Ethic waited patiently for Benjamin as he emerged from the house. He popped the locks, giving Benjamin access to his car. You ready? He asked as he grabbed a .45 caliber chrome pistol by the nose and handed it to Benjamin with a gloved hand. Yes, God! Ooh, we love a chrome 4-5. Listen, Linda. Y'all better start going to the range. It's just a lot of fun to get aggression out. And then you get proficient at it. And then your group and get tight. And then you get scared because you know you could end somebody's life real sweet, you know, if they fuck up and find out. Moving on. Benjamin nodded his head and accepted the weapon. He cocked the weapon back, putting a bullet in the chamber, and nodded as Ethic pulled away from the curve. Jay-Z's reasonable doubt filled the interior. Yes, God. Nice music to be on your way to get some dirt done, you heard me? To put in that wet work. They needed a real nigga to spit real shit as they prepared to partake in the most real part of the game. They each knew that murder was final, and there was no turning back. There was nothing glamorous about this part of their professions. Niggas had violated, and now it was time to pay the piper by annihilating everyone the Jack Boys had ever loved. It would be a hard lesson to teach, but it had to be done so that the streets could learn that Benjamin Atkins was not to be fucked with. That night, Ethic and Benjamin took the lives of three individuals, the mother of one of the Jack Boys, the girlfriend and son of the other. All were extinguished because their loved ones had broken the rules and committed the ultimate sin. If the king was going to be overthrown, it had to be done right. If not, the repercussions would prove deadly, and Benjamin Atkins ruthlessly reminded the entire city of that on a cold, rainy night. What about the kid, Mizan? Ethic asked. You want to handle that? Something telling me that he's a snake-ass nigga. It was too coincidental that all of this popped off the day he came to your crib. Benjamin's eyes were cold, but his heart was conflicted. Taking the lives of innocent women and children had him internally disturbed, but he had known that it had to be done. Benny, you want me to take care of it? Ethic asked, seeing the familiar look of uncertainty in the old man's gaze. Benjamin shook his head and said, I'm not 100% sure that he was behind this, and because of that, I'll give him a pass. If he did have something to do with it, he will get the picture. There's been enough killing tonight. Ethic didn't understand Benjamin's reasoning, but did not question him. He made a note to be aware of his surroundings and keep an eye out for Mizan. Ethic knew a snake-ass nigga when he saw one, and Mizan was it. Child, listen. I tell you what, no God. Mizan's entire world went black as he stood over his mother's grave. She was the only person he cared about, the only person who had yet to give up on him, and now she was gone. It wasn't a pained emotion that swept over him, more like rage from being disrespected. He had no doubt that Benjamin Atkins was behind the vicious hit because he had gotten word that Bull's chick and son had been murdered as well. This was a message to the streets from Benjamin, and Mizan heard it loud and clear. Unfortunately, or sorry, rather, fortunately, Mizan and his brother Boo had different fathers, giving them different last names, so Benjamin had not been able to link Boo to him. Otherwise, he would be taking a dirt nap too. This nigga want to make it personal, Mizan thought angrily. He pulled out his cell phone and dialed Raven's number. He was even more determined to get at Benjamin now. He was going to fuck up his entire existence, starting with his pretty little daughter, Raven. She was his way in, and he was going to fuck her in every sense of the word until he eventually destroyed her father. And that's the end of that chapter. Child, listen. I don't even understand. I just feel like... Oh my God, he should have listened to Ethel. Child. I don't even, okay, we're gonna do it anyway. That's what we do around here. We keep going because I am liking it. I ain't gonna lie. I like it. All right, here we go. Chapter 4. Raven lay in bed wide awake as she waited for her father to come tell her goodnight. She knew him too well, and he would always come to peek inside her room before he retired to his bedroom. When she heard his footsteps coming down the hall, she closed her eyes, pretending to be asleep. She felt him come in and sit on her bed, the weight of his body causing it to sink down. Ray, you asleep? He asked gently. Raven didn't respond. Benjamin leaned down and kissed her forehead, then tucked the covers tightly around her. I love you, he said. I love you too, she responded in her head as she heard him leave the room. Despite his warnings, Raven had been sneaking out to see Mizan almost every night for the past 2 months. She did not care if her father disapproved. She was feeling him and was willing to do anything to be around him. She waited another 10 minutes just to make sure that he wouldn't come back before she hopped out of bed fully clothed. She looked at the clock. She was already 20 minutes late. Mizan had told her to meet him at midnight. I hope he didn't pull off, she thought, as she opened her second-story bedroom window. She climbed out quietly and crept across the roof, then jumped down onto the top of the garage. She cringed as her feet hit the shingles, making a soft thud, and froze to see if anyone had heard her. When she was sure that she was in the clear, she climbed down the cable pole that sat directly next to the garage and walked away into the night. Child, listen. Hold on, y'all. I'm on a live stream, ma'am. I'll have to call you back. Goodbye. I said I'm on a live stream, bitch. Bye. I'll call you back. Bye. Sorry, y'all. Good googly boogly. All right. All right. Let me find my place back, child. All right. When she saw Mizan's headlights in the distance, she took off running toward him. She tapped his passenger window. The smile he gave her when he saw her was worth all the risk she was taking by sneaking out of her parents' house. You ready? He asked. She nodded and he pulled off, heading back to his place. When she entered, she saw rose petals and candles decorating the living room of the three-bedroom house. To a grown woman, this might have been routine or even been looked at as game, but to an inexperienced teenager, this simple gesture easily won her over. Because her game is whack. Whack as fuck. She looked up at him in surprise. You did all this for me? He nodded as he took her hand and pulled her down on the couch. He slid his hand underneath his couch and pulled out a small box filled with pre-rolled blunts. He lifted one out and waved it in front of her face. You want to blaze up? He asked, remembering the way that the weed and coke concoction made her feel. A smile creased her lips, and she nodded eagerly. I'm sorry about everything that has happened. My daddy is dead wrong for telling me I can't see you, she said sincerely, as they fell into a puff-puff pass rotation. Why would you tell the nigga? Oh, my God. Why would you tell him? Oh, my God. This bitch is dumb. Just dumb because it's Monday afternoon at 4:37. Yes, I am. Okay, right. Get your ass on the floor. Absolutely. And I'm not asking. I'm just going to put your ass there. Nice and neat. Yes. Okay, I know that's right. And listen, you need to go to the long gun range too, because that's what you protect your house with. But we'll have to talk about that at another time. But every woman needs a cute little something-something to carry around in her handbag. Or if you live in a state that has open carry, you become Jesus Christ, keeping your hammer on your hip like a carpenter always does, honey, in your tool belt of sorts. Maybe I'm in Texas. We can carry everywhere except for hospitals and schools and government buildings. And I don't fuck around. So listen. All right. Anyway. He is just overprotective. I don't want him to run you away. He grabbed her chin and put his fingers to her lips to silence her. He leaned in and kissed her. I'm not running, Ma. There's not a nigga in the world that can keep me from you. Believe that, he replied, blowing her head up as he continued to kiss her. She was high, and every spot he touched made her love gush in anticipation. Raven felt her body submit to him as his hands roamed all over her. Girl, that's the drugs again. Her heartbeat sped up and was pounding so rapidly that she was sure that it would beat out of her chest. She wanted to be a good girl to tell him no and make him wait, but the spot between her legs began to pulse and all rational thought went out of the window. To keep a big boy like Mizan, she would have to do big girl things. To stop him now would be a crime. With his hands palming her breast beneath her shirt and his fingers teasing her hard nipples, her hormones were in overdrive. It felt so good, but at the same time, it scared her. Although she talked big shit and flirted openly, Raven was still a virgin. No one had ever touched her the way that Mizan was now. She had never let a guy get this close, but Mizan had set the stage, and now it was time for her to perform. Raven pulled back from him, breathing heavily, as she looked him in the eyes. Wait, I don't know what I'm doing, she said, her voice quivering. I've never done this before, she admitted. Mizan smirked, feeling like a king with the realization that he was about to be her first. I'm gonna show you, he whispered, as he got on his knees and removed her jean shorts, revealing her soaking wet panties. He pulled him off, sat back for a minute, enjoying the sight of her pussy, her silky hairs enticing him with the scent of a pure virgin. "What are you doing?" she whispered insecurely. "What make you feel good? Just relax," he promised. He opened her up. Wait a minute. He opened up her southern lips and watched as her juicy peach excreted her natural juices. "Damn, Ma," he said in awe as he put his mouth on her clit without hesitation. "Ah," she moaned instantly. "Wait, did she turn 18 yet? Is it August yet? Because otherwise, I feel weird." Oh, didn't she say she turned 18 in August? For the past 2 months, she said she would be 18 in 2 months. Okay, all right, all right. So we good, we good. Woo, shit, child. She a grown woman, YouTube, okay? Her back arched while Mizan put his tongue to work. He put his hands under her ass cheeks and spread her wide open as he licked her from her crack all the way to her pearl. All right, Mizan. She squirmed beneath him. She had never felt anything like it. Even when she would touch herself, it never felt so good. Her head fell back in ecstasy, and her nipples were tingling as if they were begging for attention. She removed her shirt, exposing her perky D-cups. She took her nipples between her fingers as she grinded into his face. Her moans of passion filled the air. Mizan was a cunnilingus expert, and he made love to her with his mouth, knowing that it wouldn't bring her pain. He wasn't ready to break her in yet. He wanted to blow her mind without ever sticking his dick inside of her. He was going to make her wait for it, but in the meantime, the sweetness of her satisfied him. He stroked his 9 inches while blessing her with oral sex. The way she fed her pussy to him, pushing it against his face, let him know that he was doing it right. She tasted so good, so fresh. There was nothing like the taste of unexplored pussy, and he lapped up her young juices as if he was sucking on a summer peach. He pulled her to the edge of the couch, both of her thighs encompassing his head as she wound her body, riding his tongue while her perky breasts bounced in the air. He couldn't wait to twist her back out. He knew that it was going to feel like heaven, but he was also aware that she wasn't ready for it yet. In time, he would have her right where he wanted her. He began to pull on her clit while his full lips encompassed it, driving her crazy. He moaned as he continued to suck her into an orgasm. Her legs began to shake and her eyes rolled in the back of her head. "Oh, my son, something's wrong. It's too tender. It feels too good," she whispered as tiny bolts of lightning erupted inside her. "What are you doing to me?" "I'm making you come," he moaned seductively as she exploded in his mouth. All of the energy left her body as she melted into the leather couch. A layer of sweat glistened on her body, causing her to stick to the fabric. He came up for air, wiping his mouth with his hand. He stood. She was eye level with his penis. She gasped at its size. It was big and thick, with veins protruding from it. The head was blossomed, and her eyes bulged as she took it into her hands. "Put it inside me," she whispered unsurely. She wanted to prove to him that she wasn't a little girl and make him feel the same bliss he had just bestowed upon her. "Nah, Ma, you're not ready for that. I would tear that young pussy up. Stroke it for daddy," he instructed as she began to rub him up and down slowly. "Wet the tip," he said as he looked down at her. The sight of his toned body made her horny all over again. Raven had never sucked a dick a day in her life, but she couldn't stop now. "If I don't do it, he won't fuck with me anymore. Just quit being a baby and get it over with," she told herself. Wait a minute. Oh, my God. That sounds like a honeymoon night. Pause. Oh, my God. Wait a minute. Okay. Raven knew about chicks at her high school who sucked dick, but they all were labeled hoes for doing so. What she didn't know was that grown women gave superhead to their men without hesitation. Had nothing to do with being a hoe. Little girls worried about trivial things like that. Grown women knew that pleasing their men every now and then kept their kings happy, allowing them to keep their positions, because what a wifey won't do, another bitch will. So, a grown woman covered all her bases by being a freak in the bed, but a lady in the streets. The smell of sweaty balls in their faces was a small sacrifice to keep their spots on lock. Pause. I know you lying. If you got sweaty balls, well, wait. Stay out my my goddamn business, Marva. I'm just saying, like, you know, for regular degular, you know, you don't want sweaty ass balls in your face. But sometimes, you know, every now and then, you be like, you just finished working out, come in. You know what I'm saying? That's different. So that's a every once in a while type of thing. You know what I'm saying? Anyway, Raven would have to push her little girl mentality to the side if she was going to deal with an older dude. She took him into her mouth and instantly began to gag. Don't laugh at me, Kay. I'm just... I'm just saying, you know, and you like sweaty balls every now and then. Y'all always up in my damn business. Lord have mercy. Okay. Back to the book. Relax your throat and watch your teeth, Mizan coached patiently, teaching her how to give head as he looked down at her. Raven attempted again, but her body language was all wrong. The back of her throat was tense and her teeth too close for comfort. Wait a minute, Mom. Hold up. You just need some confidence, he whispered as he pulled out a small bag of cocaine. Listen, Linda. He finna have her snorting cocaine. Oh! I told y'all, this nigga's trash. He moved quickly, laying two lines out on the coffee table in front of him. Hit this with me, he instructed. Raven shook her head. I don't do blows, she whispered. It'll make you relaxed, Ma. You'll be hitting me off like a pro, he whispered as he teased her nipples with his fingertips. And I'd have told him, well, motherfucker, I guess I'm gonna hit you off like an amateur. As a matter of fact, I'm about to hit you in your motherfucking balls, and you could take me back to the crib, pimp. Because it's bad enough you just fucked me up with the fucking sugary blunts over here. And now you're trying to have me on the booger sugar too? No, God. Like, what the fuck is wrong with this dude? Anyway, he leaned down over the table and inhaled one of the lines using a small straw. See? That's all there is to it. Raven slowly got down on her knees and pulled her hair out of her face. She put her face over the cocaine as she gripped. Just like that. Now sniff real hard, he coached. As he watched her take her first line, the sight of it making his manhood stand at attention. Oh, he the worst type of nigga, yo. Cause he getting excited thinking about her getting hooked. Bitch ass nigga. Oh, she got to shoot him in the dick. This is terrible. Raven did as she was told, and as soon as the drug entered her nose, she closed her eyes tightly. A horrible stinging sensation took over. Give it a minute, Ma. It's your first time, Mizan whispered in her ear as he began to kiss her neck. The sight of her was so appealing to him. Just the fact that she was willing to experiment with blow at his request pleased him. She was moldable, impressionable. No, sir, she's fucking stupid. Raven's stomach began to churn and she inhaled deeply. Oh my God, what the fuck, she thought miserably. But the more the drug began to ease into her system, the better she began to feel. Her young peach was juicier than it had ever been, and small moans escaped her as Mizan continued to suck on her neck and palm her breasts. Suck it for me, Ma, he said seductively. The cocaine blocked out everything, and this time she did not overanalyze his request. She opened her mouth and invited him in, sucking it timidly. Keep it wet and stroke it, Ma. Not too rough. Don't use your teeth, he said completely in the moment as she got her groove and he closed his eyes. He began to grind slowly, and she put her hands on his firm buttocks as she pulled him into her. He repositioned himself as he lay on the couch and pulled her back down on top of him in a 69. He opened her pussy back up, pleasuring her while she gave him head. He tickled her rectum with his wet finger while simultaneously French kissing her lips. She deep-throated him, all of a sudden becoming an expert. The more pleasure he gave her, the better job she did, lowering all of her inhibitions. Damn, Ray, suck it, Ma, he whispered. Raven's mouth felt numb, but she kept going, wanting nothing more than to please him, to prove herself to him. They both exploded, and Raven stroked him until she had milked him dry, then sat up with a satisfied look on her face. He grabbed her hand and led her into the shower, where they kissed under the stream of water until it ran cold. When they stepped out, he wrapped a towel around his waist and then held one out for her. She fell into his embrace and stood on her tiptoes to kiss him. She couldn't stop tasting him. Every time he touched her, she felt special. and she lowered her head to her chest as she thought about what had just taken place. I've never done this with anybody, Mizan. Please don't put my business out there to all your friends. I know how dudes can be, she whispered. He lifted her chin and replied, you're my little mama. I don't want another nigga to know what my bitch got. I have to kill a nigga for coming at you, trying to take what's mine. Huh? Oh, I don't know. Did you look? Okay. He said? Okay. I'm sorry. Okay. Sorry, y'all. My son talking to me. He put his hands between her legs and caressed her lips. This my pussy? He asked. She pursed her lips, raised her arched eyebrows, and replied, it's yours. He pointed his finger in her face. Then don't ever give away what belongs to me, Raven, he answered seriously. She grabbed his hand and kissed it as she looked into his eyes. I won't, she replied honestly. She had never felt the way Mizan had made her feel. She had no idea that she had just given her heart away. She was too young to recognize that Mizan was a bad seed. All she saw was his hood swagger and good looks. She was blinded by the idea of being wifey, and the fact that he came from nothing appealed to her even more. Her parents had worked hard to keep her away from the streets, but Mizan's soul was lost in the streets, and as long as she was with him, hers would be too. Young and naive, Raven did not know that she was merely a pawn in Mizan's chess game, and his goal was to take down the king of the streets, her father, Benjamin Atkins. Child, listen. Ooh, I'm so annoyed with this dumbass gal. I want to punch her in the throat, shake her till she get that quiet, peaceful look on her face and say, don't be a dumb hoe. Oh, my God. Oh, Lord. Mizan pulled into Raven's subdivision at 6 o'clock in the morning. After staying up all night with him and getting to know one another, she wasn't ready to say goodnight, but she knew that her mother awoke at 7 a.m. sharp. She had to get in before someone discovered she was gone. He led her out of the corner and reached over to open her car door. See, a real nigga wouldn't even do no shit like that. They would be more respectful of your fucking pappy, but this is a snake. He is fucking snail sludge. Trash. Dumpster juice. Fucking dog. Sorry. He reached over to open her car door. You mean he didn't even get out and open the door to drop her off at the corner? He treating her like a food stamp hoe. Opening the door. Bum. He kissed her cheek and she exited the car. She headed for her house at the other end of the block. She noticed that all the lights were still out in her house, and she sighed in relief. Just as she was approaching her driveway, she heard someone call her name. Raven! She jumped out of her skin and turned around, knowing she was busted. She put a hand to her chest and exhaled in relief when she saw Ethic sitting in an apple red Benz. Ooh, a dark-skinned nigga in a red vehicle. Oh, a hammer. She stepped over to the car, not too excited to see him. What are you doing out here this time of night? She asked with her hands on her hips. I could be asking you the same thing, he commented condescendingly. I live here, so I don't owe you an explanation, she shot back with a snotty attitude, leaning down so that she could talk to him through the window. Get in, he said in a low tone as he unlocked the doors. She opened the door and plopped down in the passenger seat. Your father asked me to watch the crib. After what happened at the fish fry, he's a little paranoid, he explained. He stared at her intently, making her feel uncomfortable. She felt as if he could see right through her. Why are you staring? She asked. He ignored her question and posed one of his own. Why are you fucking with a nigga that can't drop you off at your doorstep? Ethic asked, his calm demeanor not revealing any emotion in his tone. Why do you care? Raven asked in confusion. Her body was beginning to feel sluggish as she came down off of her cocaine high, and she did not have time for Ethic to be butting into her business. I don't. I just think that you should, he responded bluntly. Your man is a jack boy. I had my people check him out after what went down at the party. You're going through an awful lot of trouble for someone who doesn't care, she commented and folded her arms across her chest. I don't care how he gets his paper as long as he gets it. I like him, and he doesn't think I'm too young to be his girl. Besides, he had nothing to do with what happened. He was with me the entire time, she defended. Ethic smirked and shook his head. Open your eyes, little girl. Tired of hearing him speak, Raven reached for the door. Just mind your business. You already told me you're not interested in me. I found someone who is. So, me and you, we really don't have anything to talk about. You do you, and I'll do me, Raven stated as she got out and closed the door. Ethic got out of the car to go after her. She was halfway across the street before he caught up with her. He grabbed her by the arm and turned her toward him, pulling her closely so that he didn't have to speak too loud. "Look, Raven, I don't want to see you out in the streets with that nigger Mizan. I've heard about how he gets down, and I have no love for a stick-up nigger. I've got a lot of money invested with your pops, and if he's constantly worried about you, then his mind ain't on what it should be on. Know what I mean? I'm not trying to get caught slipping, and if I even think your little boyfriend barking up my tree, I'm gonna snuff his lights out. That's what I'm talking about. That's right." He looked Raven up and down. "Nigga got you out here climbing out of windows and getting in cars on corners like a hoe. And that's the type of nigga you feeling? You should follow your own advice and be more selective of who you spend your time with, Mom." He was standing so close to her that she could smell the peppermint on his breath. Ooh. Mm-mm-mm. He made her nervous, and the harsh way he came at her made her eyes water. The fact that it bothered Ethic to see her with Mizan made her heart flutter nervously. She didn't want to pull away from him. It felt too good to be in his space, but she did it anyway. It was clear that he wasn't interested, so she couldn't understand why it was so much of a problem for him to see her with another dude. "I'm not a little girl. I can handle myself. Mizan isn't who you think he is," she replied. Ethic chuckled slightly as he rubbed the top of his head. "I guess you learned a lot about him in the short time you've known him," he replied sarcastically, making her feel stupid. "Why are you so mean?" she asked. "You talk to me like I'm beneath you or something, but you want me to listen to you when it comes to my man?" She scoffed and waved her hand in dismissal. "Your man?" he asked incredulously. "Yeah, my man," she stated firmly as she stormed away. "Raven?" Ethic called out. She stopped and turned to face him. "What?" she answered with teary eyes. "I'm not trying to hurt your feelings. I just want you to be careful. You're too green, huh? You're a target simply because of who you are." Raven put her hand on her hip and looked at him, baffled. "You sure talk about me like you know me. Did you get all of that in the short time you have known me? You must forget, I don't know you any better than I know him. So who says you are so trustworthy?" She walked away and climbed up to her bedroom. When she turned to look out the window, Ethic had gotten back into his car. She pushed him out of her mind and went to sleep. And that's the end of that chapter. Child, she should have kept him on her fucking mind. Because, child, you are with a whole bum-ass nigga. I don't even understand. He's trash. Absolute fucking trash. I'm so annoyed. So that's the end of that chapter, y'all. I'm sorry. So Kim Cash says, "Saki, I love how you be into the book. Audible could never do what you do. I swear you be having me." Girl, thank you, darling. I just be sharing with y'all my honest reactions to the mess that be going on in these books, child. Yes. Yes, her daddy kept her too green. That's what I'm saying. He should have been blew that nigga's candle out. I'm telling you. I swear. Sometimes you got to grind a nigga meat. Right? Because, listen, they just be too damn raggedy. They just need to get out. Yes, I wish Ethic would tell her daddy that she hopping out of cars with niggas in the middle of the fucking morning, early in the morning, like a dime street hoe. Oh, I don't even understand, child. Just garbage, trash.
Ooh. Here comes the money.
Here we go.
Money talk.
Here comes the money. Money, money, money.
Thank you, Miss Marva, for the Cash App, darling. I appreciate you. And she said, "For thank you." I truly appreciate you, darling. Thank you. Thank you. Do y'all be getting a lot of spam, child? Because sometimes I be getting a bunch of spam. Like, I don't know. I be feeling like somebody done fucking, like you sign up for shit and they be fucking selling your email address and shit. Oh, Diamond, you a cutie. Hey, pretty girl. I just accepted your request. Oh, you cute. All right. That's not me hitting on you, child. I'm strictly dickly. But I just, when women are cute, I tell them that they cute. And I don't say that too often, but you are cute. I know some cute chicks on YouTube. Some ugly-ass bitches on YouTube, too. But I'm about my goddamn business. Oh, my God. But you ain't one of them, girl. You cute. Mm-mm. Yeah, Marva, I swear, it's like, I don't know if the if it's like your insurance company that sells your fucking email ad, girl, I don't know who be selling your email address, but I tell you what, the fucking shit is annoying because it's just like, what the hell? Like, why? I don't understand it. Don't sell because they swear up and down. Oh, we would never spam you. You a damn lie. Yeah, you don't spam me, but the cocksuckers you sell my email address to, dude. Like, the fuck? Don't sell my damn email address. Hell. But I just go ahead on and I just send their ass right on to the damn spam pool and call it a day. That part. I don't have no qualms about walking away from a fucking email address. Bye, bitch. Next. All right. So, it says this next chapter is 13 minutes. All right. So that'll put us at 2.5 hours. So I'm going to give y'all that. And then I'm going to stop. Matter of fact, let me draw my line. Bam. Right there. Like so, like that. And let me get my time stamp, y'all. Ooh, and we did this without a bathroom break, y'all. We is getting good. All right. I mean, we cooking with gas over here, child. Okay. Let's get into it so we can get back here. Chapter 5. Raven pulled up to Nikki's house and honked her horn. She came running out and hopped into the car. Hey, bitch, what's up? Nikki greeted as they pulled away. I saw Mizan last night, Raven said. She couldn't wait to fill her best friend in on the amazing night she had. What? How? He came and got me. We went back to his place, Raven said vaguely. And, bitch, Nikki grilled, waiting for Raven to say more. And nothing. You don't need to know all my business, Raven replied with laughter, knowing that the suspense was killing Nikki. Okay, Marva, thank you for coming by, and thank you again for the Cash App, darling. Have a good day. All right. Okay. Oh, you know you coming better than that, Nikki said as she leaned her back against the passenger door so that she was facing her best friend. Did you fuck him? She asked. Not exactly, Raven stated. Oh my God, you did. Tell me everything, she said, eager to know the juicy details. Raven shook her head and replied, good girls never tell. As she pulled up to Hamity High School, Nikki pointed to the rear of the parking lot. Well, you did something right, because there go your boy right there, she stated. Raven parked her car next to Mizan's and smiled. What are you doing here, she asked sweetly. I wanted to see you. He rested his arm on the top of his steering wheel. Come take a ride with me for a minute. Raven looked at Nikki and said, if anybody asks, just say you drove my car to school. I'll meet you back here after the last class. Nikki smiled knowingly. Hi, girl. You know I got you. Hey, Mizan. Mizan nodded and waited for Raven to switch cars before speeding off. Mizan knew that the way to win Raven over would be to show her with his time and affection. I think she meant shower her with his time and affection. Financially, there was nothing he could give her. He knew that by being the daughter of Benny Atkins, she had everything she could ever want, so he wouldn't try to compete with that. He was going to give her what she obviously craved, attention. Mizan made her feel like his world revolved around her. Every move was calculated carefully in an intricate plot to get her to trust him. He wanted her to be so wrapped up in him that she would do anything he asked. Child, listen, bastard. They spent the entire day together, chilling and getting high together at his house. Being there with him made her feel like an adult. There were no prying eyes and no boundaries. When she was with Mizan, he respected her and let her do what she wanted. She loved the freedom and valued every minute she spent with him. The day ended too soon for her, but she knew she had no choice but to leave. She had to meet Nikki back at the school once classes were over. I don't want to leave you, she whispered as she lay on his chest. Then stay. I can't. I have to get home before my parents wonder where I am, but I want to see you again. Soon, she whispered. Can you meet me at the school tomorrow morning? Yeah, I'll be there. He kissed her forehead. Mizan was going to have to put a lot of effort into Raven in order for his plan to work, but he was confident that in the end, it would all be worth it. This routine went on for weeks, and the closer she got to Mizan, the more she pushed her father away. She was tired of being controlled, and by disobeying Benjamin, she felt like she was proving her independence. She didn't notice that she was simply shifting the control to Mizan. On top of that, the daily weed and cocaine use was slowly turning her out. She found herself sneaking out with Mizan every chance she got. He kept her high and happy. That's the way pimps treat their hoes, too. Pete game. She was quickly falling in love, and when she was not around him, she felt sick. She had a serious love, Jones, for the young thug. She was ostracizing herself from her family, but it only made her more dependent on Mizan. She was crazy over him, and she told herself that no one was going to stop them from being together. She had no idea that she was mistaking infatuation for love, but in her mind, they were one and the same. Now that she had her mind set on being with Mizan, she was determined not to let anyone tear them apart. "Come and take a ride with me, Ray," Justine requested as she popped her head into her daughter's room. "Where are we going?" Raven asked. She got up and followed her mother out of the house. "We're going to the spa. I want to talk to you about something." She lowered her sunglasses onto her face to conceal her eyes. Raven stared out the window, knowing that if her mother wanted to talk, something had to be wrong. "Now, how was school today?" Justine asked. "It was good. I'm ready for it to be over, though. I can't wait for graduation next month." "Raven, I've been around the block more times than you can count. Don't lie to me, little girl. I received a call from your counselor today. You haven't been to school in the past 3 weeks. Now, you've been leaving the house every morning. Where you been going?" Justine asked. Raven tried to think of a reasonable excuse, but Justine raised her hand to stop her. She could see the wheels turning in her daughter's head. "Don't lie to me, Raven. I know you've been sneaking around with Mizan. I wouldn't have to sneak if Daddy would just be reasonable. Your father has his reasons for everything he does. He's just trying to protect you, Ray," Justine argued. "I can't believe he would do something like this. You barely even know this boy." "I know him enough to know that I love him, and y'all can't make me stop seeing him. I'll be grown in 2 months. I can do what I want." Oh, shit. So she wasn't grown when I read that scene. Motherfucker. All right. Okay. Oh, my God. Love. "Raven, you don't even know what love is yet," Justine said, exasperated. "You're too young to even think of making that type of commitment." "You were my age when you met Daddy," Raven shot back. Justine gripped the steering wheel of the car tightly as she shook her head in disappointment. "Raven, things were different back then. When I was 17, I was on my own and paying bills, not living underneath my parents' roof and lying to get my way. You have a month left of high school. Why don't you focus on graduating? I know you think you love this boy, but it's not the real thing, Ray. I promise you, by the end of the summer, you will forget all about him." "Are you going to tell Daddy?" Raven asked. "Girl, your father knows everything that goes on underneath his roof. I don't lie to my husband. He already knows, and you can deal with him when we get home," Justine said as she finally arrived at the spa. She opened the door and got out, noticing that Raven was frozen in her seat like a deer in headlights. "You might as well get out and come enjoy this spa because you aren't going anywhere besides school anytime soon. Ain't no point in pouting now. You wanted to act grown and go see that boy. Now you have to be a grown woman and accept the consequences." "Raven, get in here," Benjamin's voice boomed as soon as she stepped in the door. Raven's mother rubbed her back soothingly as she escorted Raven to the study. Ethic was sitting in a chair across from Benjamin, and he stood when he saw her enter the room. "Ethic, can you excuse us for a minute? I need to speak with my daughter. Go and grab something to eat out the kitchen. Make yourself at home." Ethic nodded and left the room as Raven nervously sat in front of her father. Benjamin took his time before he spoke. He sat back in his chair as he loosened his necktie. "I thought I made myself clear when I told you this the first time, but obviously I did not. I'm going to say this one more time. I don't want to hear about you being around Mizan again." He was reserved, his voice low and calm, but Raven could see his temples throbbing in rage. No one else would have known how upset he was, but Raven and Benjamin shared a special connection. She knew him well enough to see past his controlled demeanor. "I love him, Daddy," Raven whispered. Her voice was so low he barely heard her, but a statement so ludicrous he could not miss. "Then you're gonna love the nigga to death, Raven, because if you keep fucking with him, I'm gonna kill him," Benjamin threatened, fully serious on carrying through if need be. "Daddy, you're not being fair. You can't tell me who to love," Raven defended, her voice quivering. Her father was the only person she could not stand up to. "As long as you're living underneath this roof, you will not disobey me, Raven. Fair has nothing to do with this. I'm trying to keep you safe," he said. "Then maybe I don't need to live under your roof," Raven shouted defiantly, causing Benjamin to stand to his feet. "Excuse me," he yelled, raising his voice at her for the first time in his life. "I'm not going to stop seeing him. You can threaten me all you want. As a matter of fact, I'm out of here," she screamed as she stormed out of his office. Benjamin was so upset that he swept all the papers and documents from his desk in one motion. Fuck! He screamed as he put his hands on his waistline and paced the room. Justine came rushing in. Benjamin, what did you do? She asked, near tears. Go upstairs and stop her. She's our baby. Let her go. She wants to be grown, so I'ma let her get out there and see what it's like. She'll be back home by tomorrow morning, Benjamin stated. Ethic sat in the living room as he heard the family argue. Morgan peeked her head inside. Ethic, where's Raven going? She signed to him as she leaned against the doorframe. Ethic, being knowledgeable in many things, knew sign language and surprised her when he signed back. She's just going out for the night. Don't worry, pretty girl. He patted the seat next to him, and Morgan smiled as she rushed to sit by his side. Is she going to live with her boyfriend? Morgan signed with a worried expression. Nah, shorty. She's not going to stay with him, Ethic replied. He could still hear Justine and Benjamin arguing as Raven descended the stairs with a suitcase in one hand and her keys in the other. Benjamin came into view. Leave the car key here, he said, speaking sternly as he stood with one hand in his pocket and the other over his mouth. Raven stared at her father, and for the first time she found herself disgusted by him. She removed the car key and put it in his hand and then removed her house key as well. You can keep that too. I won't be needing it, she said as she stormed out the front door. Pause. Baby, you'll be going out with what you got on. And you're lucky I don't pull what, who the fuck was them dudes that made JJ strip out of all they motherfucking clothes? Oh, that was Sweet Daddy. Sweet Daddy made JJ strip. Right, leave all my shit. Right, you gonna walk out of here with what you came into the world with, ass naked, with nothing but the bush covering your snatch and whatever you got growing under your arms and in the crack of your ass. Bye. Figure it out. And if I'm paying your cell phone bill, you better start a fire so your man can see it and send smoke signals, bitch, because you walking out of here with nothing. And don't call me. I don't want to hear about it. Nah, we ain't getting ready to do all that. Think you going to take a whole suitcase full of designer duds out of here that I spent my ducats on? Bitch, you got me fucked up. A compass can't even begin to point in all the directions and ways that you got me fucked up. Nobody. Mm-mm. Tears came to Benjamin's eyes as he fought to control his emotions. He was heartbroken that Raven was leaving, but he stubbornly refused to stop her. He had never been in conflict with his daughter. In all of her 17 years on Earth, she had never disrespected him so bluntly. As he pictured her face in his mind, everything in him wanted to go after her, but this was not something he would concede. He had seen many young girls led astray by dealing with the wrong man. Raven's judgment was off when it came to Mizan, and he would never approve of their relationship. After 10 minutes of pacing back and forth, he looked at Ethic and said, go make sure she's okay. That's my baby girl, he stated, becoming emotional as he pinched the bridge of his nose. Ethic nodded and began to leave when Benjamin's voice stopped him. Ethic, don't let her know that I sent you. Justine grabbed her coat and went to follow Ethic, but Benjamin grabbed her hand. No. No, Benny. No. I'm going after my daughter. You can just send her up out of here like this. I think she meant you can't just send her up out of here like this. What if something happens to my baby? Nothing's going to happen, Benjamin stated. But she has to learn that she cannot disrespect us underneath this roof. That boy is bad news. And you're just going to run her into his arms by acting like this, she argued. Justine, he said sternly. I got it. Go and put Morgan to bed. Have I ever let you down? Justine's reserve melted as hot tears burned her eyes, threatening to spill over. No, she whispered. Then trust me, he said. He nodded for Ethic to leave and then watched his wife scoop Morgan up and carry her upstairs. She stopped midway and turned around. If something happens to Raven, I will never forgive you, Benjamin. Never. I'll never forgive myself, he thought, as he watched his beautiful wife turn her back on him and ascend the staircase. Raven cried hysterically as she carried her heavy suitcase down the suburban street. I can't believe he would take my keys, she thought, outraged. She wasn't even two blocks away from her house when Ethic pulled up to her. She stuck her middle finger up at him to let him know that she wasn't trying to hear shit he had to say. Get in the car, he said, ignoring her childish antics as he rolled slowly next to her. She looked straight ahead, ignoring him. Raven, get in the car. Where you going? You just said fuck your pops to be with a nigga who don't give a damn about you. Facts. Raven ignored him and carried on. She didn't care that she had no destination. The further away she got from her father, the better. Where you going? He asked. You think old boy gonna take you in now? He asked. When she didn't answer, Ethic sighed in frustration. Just get in, huh? Why you got me out here like Keith Sweat, begging you and shit, he asked. Raven couldn't help but laugh slightly as she stopped walking. She put a suitcase on the ground and stood with her hand on her hip as she looked tentatively at Ethic. Get in, he said. Knowing that she had no place to go, she sighed and lifted her suitcase as she climbed into the car. Don't take me home. I'm not going back there, she said stubbornly. Ethic didn't respond as he pulled away from the curb. He let her into his house and threw his keys down on the coffee table. Look, I'm not your keeper. I can't tell you what to do. But if you're thinking about having that nigga come and scoop you, don't let him know where I live. You take a cab over there or something, because if he come down my block, it's going to be a problem, all right? Raven nodded her head. Do you think I'm wrong? She asked. I think you're young, Ethic said, and I think Mizan knows you're young. You don't let a nigga like him trap your heart, ma. You trying to find yourself. I get that, but a dude like that is only going to get you lost. The look of disappointment that Ethic gave Raven caused a tear to fall down her cheek. She quickly wiped it away as she watched him disappear behind closed doors. Part of her wanted to heed Ethic's advice, but to turn around and run home to her father after the scene she had made would make her look foolish. She had defied her father in order to be with Mizan, and now she had to follow through with it. Her pride matched that of a lion's, and under no circumstances was she going home. She had argued her way into a corner, and now she was on her own. She tapped her foot nervously against the floor as she sat in the dark with her arms crossed tightly over her chest. Should I call Mizan, she thought. I did all of this so that I could be with him. She picked up her phone and took a deep breath as she dialed his number. She hoped like hell that he was feeling her the same way, because if he wasn't, she had just thrown away all that she had ever known for nothing. And that's the end of that chapter. I know that's right. I was thinking the same thing, child, but I was already reading the book. And leave my goddamn suitcase, too. Get one of them fucking Walmart bags. I'll sell you a couple of fucking white plastic bags for the garbage can, or the black ones for the recycle bin, right? But you're not walking out of here with my shit. Uh-uh. Nope. Like I said, you walk out of here ass naked, but I'll sell you a black garbage bag to and you cut a hole in the top and in the side and stick your fucking you can stick your fucking head through the bottom and stick your arms out the back so you ain't ass naked. And I'll sell you another one that you can tie like a belt around your fucking waist. You can take one pair of shoes, make it count, bitch, because you about to be picking them up and putting them down. That's it. Nigga, I'm gonna tell y'all right now. Woo, Lord have mercy. The universe knew what the fuck it was doing when it gave me a son. Because I'd have been hard on a girl, you heard me? You're gonna be popping your motherfucking yang in my face, girl. I will drown you in the fucking kitchen sink, bitch. With the sprayer. Just put it right in your face. Yeah. Right. Oh my God, that is horrible, Saki. You are you going to hell, bitch. Hell. But I'm so serious. I'm just playing, but I'm so I'm so serious. My God, today kids play too much. Mm-mm. And you ain't gonna be no fresh mouth ass motherfucker. Mm-mm. Nope, number 12, cast iron skillet, baby. I'll ring your fucking bell. I'm so serious. No, God. All right, y'all. I'm so serious. Had your ass walking down the street looking like Missy Elliott in them fucking plastic bags. My neighbors be like, what a goddamn... garbage bag. Oh my God. Listen, listen. Like, listen, she got smart as a mouse. So she got to wear the latest hefty fashions. Fuck out of here. No, God. No, you don't get to play on my fucking top. I know you. You better grab some of them fucking Crocs and hit the road, Jack. No, God. You got the wrong bitch on the wrong damn day. No, God. You ain't taking shit out of here. Mm-mm. Nope. No. take off my jewelry too. You going out of here with empty loaves, with your ears smelling like earring backs. Fuck out of here. Let me get my crazy ass off of YouTube. Oh, this was fun, y'all. Thank y'all for listening to me read out loud, y'all. I hope I left y'all feeling a little bit better than you were when you got here, okay? Oh, Lord. I know y'all about to travel the highways and byways of the YouTube-verse. Y'all, please, look both ways before you cross the street, because, child, it's some cock-eyed motherfucking loose drivers at the wheel, baby. And I love y'all, and I want y'all to make it back to the speakeasy in one piece, okay? Thank you so much, Love Jones, for being such a wonderful moderator, darling. You working and moderating, moderating and working. I appreciate you, little sis. Thank you so much, and I love you to pieces, child, okay? All right, y'all. Listen, y'all enjoy the rest of y'all evening, okay? And if you do nothing else, please, salute your spirit and protect your peace. I'm glad we decided to read this little book. I think I'm going to enjoy it. That goddamn Mizan will piss me off, but I got a feeling everything going to shake out all right. And if nothing else, we're going to walk away from this shit in love with some ethic. And I'm all right with that because he's old dark-skinned nigga with a commanding presence, muscly arms. We like that. All right. Until next time, you guys. Bye, y'all.